listening to Truth To You Radio with Jono on truth2u.org. That's truth2u.org. Also available on iTunes. And g'day to Sharon from Texas, Rosita from Victoria, and Craig from Idaho, Chrissy from Texas. It is time for Pearls from the Torah portion with Keith Johnson and Nehemiah Gordon. G'day, gentlemen.
G'day, Jono. This is Nehemiah over in the hottest place on planet Earth, the Katamonim in Jerusalem. And I want to do a shout out to the ladies over in Pineland, Texas. Shalom, Shira, Ziva, and Chana, thank you for listening and for everything else that you do.
Excellent.
And I want to give a shout out to Nehemiah, who just turned his fan off just so he could be on Torah Pearls. Pearls from the Torah, rather. And the fan was going, and he shut it off because he's so committed, and I can't believe he's over there. Nehemiah, tell us what the temperature is.
Keith, I'm shouting out. Nehemiah is sweating Torah Pearls right now. He's sweating them.
I'm sweating Torah buckets right now.
Yeah, this is awesome.
Oh my goodness, my friend. Yes, you are in the hottest place on earth. You're sweating it away just so that we can have a fan-free, clear recording. Comments. We have some comments. Let me quickly read through these comments because this is a huge Torah portion. We better jump into it. But here are some comments, and I love these ones. Sandy in Florida. Sandy says, I love this show. Most days, I have you guys on all day. The Torah Pills are awesome. I love the laughter and the camaraderie. Thank you. Why do people use words that, I mean, come on.
It's an American word.
It's not an Australian word.
Okay. You three have, even though I've been studying the parashas for 6 to 7 years, there is so much to learn. You guys make it fun too. So thank you, Sandy, for commenting. Joseph said, beautiful program. Listen every week. Thank you, Joseph. Bonnie said, just wanted to say I love you guys. Y'all's Torah Pearls have been so helpful in understanding the commonly confusing portions of the Torah. Praise Yehovah in all his goodness. I appreciate y'all very much. Thank you so much for shining and sharing his light. P.S. I really love the fact that y'all share the fun, playful stuff as well, like the crunchy, unripe peach. And Nehemiah,
come on with that!
And Nehemiah speaking in Chinese. It makes me feel like part of the family.
I got a hole.
Yep. Give us a bit more Chinese. Come on.
No, that's all I remember. Daga ho.
That's all you remember.
Yeah, that's all I got. No, I got to practice.
Krista also said, thank you so much. Every week it is a joy to listen to you on Friday afternoon at work and get all pumped up for Shabbat. Now, Darren Chan, I've quoted his comments a number of times. G'day to Darren. He said, Nehemiah speaks awesome Chinese. How do you like that?
Come on with that, Darren.
There it is. Darren Chan said, you speak awesome Chinese. And he said, he nailed the accent. He said, I'm Chinese and I only know a few words like wonton soup and chow mein. Darren says, I no longer eat those foods, so I pretty much lost all my Chinese speaking ability. He said, fascinating how the Chinese people are responding so well to Nehemiah and Keith's information, a future of kosher Chinese food for everyone. That sounds good.
Come on.
Yeah.
Can I comment on what Darren said?
Please.
So I think it's really funny. Darren, who doesn't know Chinese by his own admission, says, my Chinese is Chinese is perfect. This reminds me of when I went to Mexico and I had a translator who translated everything I said. And at the end of the whole event, the translator said to me, how did I do? And I said, I don't know. I don't speak Spanish. He said, that's the right answer.
Excellent. He goes on to say, Jono, in all seriousness, your program is very effectively helping to spread the light of the Torah throughout the nations. As more people take hold of Yehovah's Torah, I envision a life of only clean foods and peaceful Shabbats. No more struggles to enjoy clean meals and the Shabbats with family and friends around us today. Living in the States, I guess I would have to return to the land to live in a beautiful world like that. We're going to be talking about that in this Torah Pills, aren't we? Indeed. Yeah. Sophia, she writes, thank you, Jono and gentlemen, for all your hard work. I enjoy that Jono reads a lot of Torah because we have a grandchild who is 4 and he doesn't read yet and he listens with us when he visits. Not everybody has a Torah/Bible, believe it or not. So there are folks that are more mature in age who do not see as well like Keith as they used to, but they hear wonderfully well still and they get to be included, don't you, Keith? Hey, little Keithy.
That's right.
Yeah. In the Torah lessons. And so she said, she makes a note of saying, you know, in ancient Israel, that's what they used to say, go and hear the Torah read. And so the people learn by listening. So she goes, I really appreciate you, Jono, being so thorough and going over many beautiful pearls. Shalom to you and yours. And that's Sophia. Thank you for that. And finally, Peggy. G'day, Peggy. Peggy's a faithful listener. She says, it is invaluable to me to hear the correct meaning of some of these verses as opposed to the incorrect translations in some versions. The only problem is that no one version seems to be consistently correct other than the original Hebrew, and I don't know if I'll ever master the language adequately enough to read it on my own. So thanks to Nehemiah for being our translator, and to Jono and Keith for making such a wonderful show possible. Thank you, Peggy, very much for that comment. Today, we are in Reeh, Deuteronomy 11:26 to 16:17, and it begins like this. Behold, I set before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing if you obey the commandments of Yehovah your God, which I command you today, and a curse if you do not obey the commandments of Yehovah your God, but turn aside from the way which I command you today to go after other gods, which you have not known. Now it shall be, when Yehovah your God has brought you into the land which you go to possess, that you shall put a blessing on Mount Gerizim and a curse on Mount Ebal. Are they not on the other sides of the Jordan towards the setting sun in the land of the Canaanites who dwell on the plain opposite Gilgal, beside the terebinth trees of Moreh? Now, that reminds me, because, well, Nehemiah, you were there recently, right? You and Yoel.
I was there at Mount Ebal, yeah.
Tell us about it. Just fill us in. I mean, there's a program. People can find it. If you type in, what was it, Mount Ebal, if you type that in, you'll find it there. Maybe I'll put a link to
it's pretty cool because, you know, this is one of the few, you know, a lot, there's like, I don't know, hundreds of maybe biblical cities that are mentioned and that we can identify today. We could say where Jericho is and where mm-hmm. you know, Shechem is and where Hebron is, but there's probably only a handful or less than 10 places where it's not just the city, it's the exact spot mentioned in the Bible that we can point to. And I mean more specifically where we're talking about not just a geographical place, but a structure, a building, something that was built that we can point to that exact thing that was built. And here this altar that they describe that God commands them to build here, that later is actually built in the book of Joshua chapter 8, that altar was discovered in 1987 by Adam Zartal, an Israeli archaeologist. And it was really off limits for pretty much the last decade after a terrorist attack that took place against people visiting there. And recently, Yoel Ben Shlomo and I were able to go there along with a group of other Israelis, and we were able to visit it. And it was very moving for me because I'd studied about this for years and always wanted to go there. And it was one of the places I knew that was just absolutely off limits because the terrorists opened fire on the Jewish pilgrims who had been coming to visit it. Mm-hmm. And so it was very moving, and people listened to the recording. And it actually solves a problem in this passage that you kind of just glossed over, which is, you know, you read this, verse 30, and, you know, probably people outside of Israel don't think much of it, but somebody in Israel hears this, like, what on earth is he saying? It says in verse 30, are they not across the Jordan? And by the way, that's really interesting because we saw the phrase across the Jordan earlier in Deuteronomy, mm-hmm. and we said it actually meant east of the Jordan. And here across the Jordan obviously means west of the Jordan, meaning this is from the perspective of somebody who is in what we call Transjordan or the Kingdom of Jordan, and he's looking over to the west side. And he has to explain that as well. He says, are they not across the Jordan after the way of the setting of the sun, is what it literally says, in the land of the Canaanites who dwell at the Arava, and Arava is essentially the Syro-African Rift Valley, and this context is actually referring to what we call today the Jordan Valley, opposite of Gilgal against Elone Moreh. And I hear that, and I'm like, wait a minute, no, Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim are not. They actually are not. You know, it says, are they not? And the answer is no, they're not in the Arava opposite of Gilgal. They are next to Elohim Moreh, though. And so this is where the confusion sets in, because Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim are actually up in the mountain. You can see the Jordan Valley from there, and so maybe I'm splitting hairs, but as you can see the plain from there. But they're probably about, I don't know, maybe 10 miles from there. And this has actually led to a lot of confusion. The confusion is that in Christian tradition, they identify Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim as these two mountains right next to Jericho, and as opposed to the place where you know everyone else identifies Mount Ebal specifically. And the archaeological discovery by Adam Zartal in 1987, this altar at Mount Ebal, proves definitively that the traditional Jewish site of Mount Ebal is correct, and that the Christian tradition in this case is actually off. And I should say that's one of several.
No,
well, to be fair, It's one of several Christian traditions, I should say. Other Christians identify it as the same place as the Jews. Mm-hmm. In this case, those Christians and all the Jews are right about where Mount Ebal is.
There you go.
Found the actual altar, which is pretty cool.
Excellent. I want to say, one of the things, Jonah, that is so cool about this, you know, this passage, is just this idea. And I love the first word when he says, I think yours says, behold. Mm. In the Hebrew, I think it's the word see, or, you know, yes, well, the word that we use, yes, see. So it's the imperative, and he's like, it's literally like he's saying, you ever tell someone like, look, you know, see this, you know, it's like he's calling their attention. He's about to put this out in front of them. And the image that he puts out in front of them isn't like Nehemiah says, it's not like a picture of something that isn't, it's actually concrete. And it was really moving for me when I heard about Nehemiah and Yoel going to this place, and then there was the news station actually went along and was there just to film Yoel and Nehemiah. Was really, you know, these guys are superstars.
Well,
they're just kidding. But no, but
you can actually see me for like half a second in the news.
Yoel shows up three or four times. It's impressive. Yeah. but really, he was looking
for the camera.
Yeah, so cool. Jonah, is just this idea that you're looking at biblical history. Mm. You're not looking at like a maybe. You know, we do this thing in a prayer to our Father where we go and we do research on where the place of the prayer was taken, and we went to 60, you know, these 60 different places, mm. and we're trying to figure it out. And you take this verse and you take this verse and you connect it and say, oh, we think this is it. Well, in this situation, you don't need all that. You actually go there and see it. And I mean, that just, I don't know. That is just amazing. What was that?
What was that?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, he just hit the fan.
What? No.
Are you all right?
I was wiping the sweat off of my face.
It sounded like your head exploded.
I must have hit the mic, so.
Okay.
So repeat what you just said, Keith.
Yeah, no, we're good.
All right. King up from chapter 12. These are the statutes.
Oh, chapter 12. Hold on a second. We got chapter 11, the end here, is extremely important.
Oh, okay.
Because we got a really interesting contrast here. We've got the blessing and the curse, mm. and there's terms for the blessing and there's terms for the curse. And to me, it jumps off the page.
Okay.
So the blessing, it says, if you listen or obey the commandments of Yehovah your God, which I am commanding you today, and the curse, if you do not obey the commandments of Yehovah your God and you turn from the way which I am commanding you today to go after other gods which you did not know. Mm. And it's interesting. So those are the two possibilities. You obey the commandments or you don't obey the commandments and go after other gods. So I've got a question. Mm. What if you don't obey the commandments, but you worship the true God? You say, I worship the God of Moses, but I don't keep Moses' commandments.
How can you worship God if you don't keep his commandments? I don't understand how those two things are reconciled.
Exactly. And these are the only two choices that Moses presents. He says, look, and he presents two pictures. That's the opening word, see, look, and then there's two pictures.
Mm-hmm.
There's the picture of obedience to Jehovah, or there's worshiping another God. And I think what he's saying here is if you don't obey the commandments of the creator of the universe, then you're worshiping some other God. You're worshiping God who didn't give those commandments, who mm-hmm. doesn't care about those commandments. Even if you call him Yehovah, even if you call him Yahweh, even if you call him by his true name, whatever that is, and you say, I worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but I'm disregarding his commandments, then you've created a God out of your own heart. It's no longer the God of Scripture. And that reminds me of this verse, and I think we've quoted it before. It's in 2 Chronicles 15:3, the prophecy of Azariah, son of Oded. And I won't spend too much time on it, but it says, in many days for Israel, without the true God, and without the teaching priest, and without the Torah. And I think the lesson here is, you might call this God, the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Scripture. But if you're not following the Torah, then it's not the true God.
Amen.
And Jonah, I would like to. I do want to refer back because we, you know, and again, what's so lovely? And I use the word carefully, lovely, about being in Deuteronomy is that we have this whole foundation behind us. You know, I have to tell everyone it's overwhelming to me. I was just explaining to my sons this morning as they were saying, "Oh, you're about to do your radio program," and so they ask about it. And one of the things that I said to them that I love about this is that this isn't something we're just doing for the now, but it's something that will extend, meaning that people next year, if they wanted to, they could go to Deuteronomy mm. chapter 5 and listen to it. Or 2 years, you know, if the redemption doesn't come, they could go to Exodus chapter 20. But what's so powerful mm. about the foundation that we've laid regarding going through these Torah portions is that when I hear this verse in Deuteronomy, and I'm imagining being there on the plains, and I'm there and I'm listening to Moses, the first thing that comes to my mind is the first command. You know, whether you want to say it's the first or the second command, there's argument about that. Anochi Yehovah Eloheka, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. You shall have no other gods before me. Mm-hmm. And that being the first thing that he tells the people, this is no small thing. This is, if I can say, if the recording would have ended after he introduced who he was and you shall have no other gods before me, if that was the only thing we had, that would be very significant. And I'm not saying it's the only thing we have, but it's a core issue that's throughout the Tanakh. And as we read scripture later, as you and Yoel are doing and as other people have done and gone through these other sections, what becomes the big issue? People begin to ask themselves, how can we go after another God? That even happens at the base of the mountain. And so when we get to this in Deuteronomy and he says, okay, here's the two options, I'm thinking immediately of the first command, the second command, again, depending on your point of reference, but that would be the thing that he would say. Now look, no other gods. And it's like he's, it's not like he's saying, you know, it, I mean, he knows that this is going to be the case. No other gods now. Mm. And what becomes the issue? It's the other gods.
It's the other gods.
Yeah.
And so. And chapter 12 really is a verse that really stresses the point. It says, these are the statutes and the judgments which you shall be careful to observe in the land which Jehovah your God is of your fathers is giving you to possess all the days that you live on the earth. You shall utterly destroy the places where the nations which you shall dispossess serve their gods on the high mountains and on the hills and under every green tree, and you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, burn their wooden images with fire. You shall cut down the carved images of their gods and destroy their names from that place. You shall not worship Yehovah your God with such things, but you shall seek the place where Yehovah your God chooses out of all your tribes to put his name for his dwelling place, and there you shall go. There you shall take your burnt offerings, your sacrifices, your tithes, your heave offerings from your hand, the vowed offerings, the freewill offerings, the firstborn of your herds of flocks, and you shall eat before Yehovah your God, and you shall rejoice in the land, rejoice in all to which you have put your hand, and your households in which Jehovah your God has blessed you. You shall not at all do as we are doing here today, every man doing whatever is right in his own eyes, for as yet you have not come to the rest in the inheritance which Jehovah your God is giving you. But when you cross over the Jordan and dwell in the land which Jehovah your God is giving you to inherit, and he gives you rest from all the enemies around about so that you dwell safely, then there will be a place where Jehovah your God chooses to make his name abide, and you shall bring all that I command you, the burnt offerings, the sacrifices, the tithes, the heaves offerings of your hand, and the choice offerings which you vow to Jehovah, and you shall rejoice before Jehovah your God, and you and your sons and your daughters and your male and female servants and the Levites who's within your gates, since he has no portion nor inheritance with you. Take heed to yourself that you do not offer your burnt offerings in every place that you see, but in the place which Jehovah chooses in one of your tribes, there you shall offer the burnt offerings, and there you shall do all that I command.
So first of all, we've got in verse 2, we've got this statement about the high hills, the high mountains and on the hills and under every leafy tree, every green tree. And this becomes a theme that repeats itself throughout the Bible, especially in the latter prophets, where this becomes the perennial sin of Israel, that they do exactly this. What they do is they take the Canaanite places of worship, which will become known as the high places, on every top of every hill and under every leafy tree, and they say, okay, we're going to worship our God here. And this becomes the focus of what I call spiritual mixing of seed. They're worshiping the true God, but they're worshiping him according to the manner that the Canaanites worship their gods rather than the way that he commanded. And this is exactly what he commands them not to do in verse 4. He says, you shall not do thus to Jehovah your God or for Jehovah your God. In the way that they worship their gods, don't worship me that way. And then he reiterates this at the end of the chapter, which maybe we can really quickly jump ahead to.
Sure.
And then we'll leave the middle of the chapter for a separate discussion. So verses 30 to 31, can you read that, Jono?
Yeah.
Which reiterates this point.
So it's, let me go from 29. It says, when Jehovah your God cuts off from before you the nations which you go to dispossess, and you displace them and dwell in their land. Take heed to yourself that you are not ensnared to follow them after they are destroyed from before you, that you do not inquire after their gods, saying, how did these nations serve their gods? I will do likewise. You shall not worship Yehovah your God in that way. For every abomination which Yehovah which he hates, they have done to their gods, for they even burn their sons and their daughters in the fire to their gods. Whatever I command you, you be careful to observe. You do not add to it nor take away from it.
Okay, so what he's saying here is, don't worship me the way that they worship their gods. Don't think that's doing honor to me. I told you what I want. I gave you commandments, and don't add to those and don't take away from those. Just do what I told you to do. And I think that's very important, because a lot of people will look at literally the way pagans worship their gods. This is actually one of the most common things that you see in the history of religions, that when one religion comes along, they'll adopt a lot of the holy sites and holy and religious practices of the previous religion. And anybody who studies, you know, really any history of religions will see this. You see this with the Romans adopting the gods of the Greeks, and unfortunately you see this with Israel adopting the gods of the Canaanites and many of the Canaanite ways of worship. And the prophets, you know, speak about this almost endlessly. So this is something that we have to be very careful about, not to worship Yehovah according to the ways of the pagans, to worship him according to what he commanded, according to his ways. And another thing to look at here is in verse 5, or do you guys have anything you want to add to that?
Well, I was just going to say, one of the things that I love about the Hebrew language is this idea of the picture that it gives you. When you're reading in English, certainly we do a fair job of being able to give images, but this idea of what he wants them to do in verse 3, when he says, break down their altars and smash their sacred stones. And this was something that, you know, some years ago that I really had what I'd call a picture of. And I don't know if I remember. I think I might have shared this with you guys at one point, that when I worked with the Vikings, there was a man who sent to the players, each of them, an elephant. And he sent this to the players, and he said, and this was like a lot of money. I mean, this was really nice. He sent one to, and it was, you got to remember, there's 60-some players plus others, so there's 80-some people. So he creates these quote-unquote beautiful elephants, and he sends a little letter, and it says, and this is what you're to do with this elephant. It will bring good luck, and blah, 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 blah. And so he sends it to them, and they each get one. And so one guy comes to me, and he says, Keith, here's this elephant. Can you tell me what I should do with this elephant? Well, one of the things that's beautiful about the Bible is, you know, when you look and you find out, okay, the word that's being used here when he says to smash is the same word that's being used to break. But that the idea, I think, and if I'm looking right, I think it's in the PL. Yeah, so it's an intensification of breaking, to smash it. So one of the things I did, Jonah and Nehemiah, is I brought this elephant before the team at a chapel service, and I brought out a hammer. And I
You put the hammer on the table, huh?
No, I didn't put the hammer on the table. I put the little elephant in the bag. Now, ahead of time, I got to tell you the story. Ahead of time, I got a phone call because the owner of the team approved for each player to get this elephant. True story, I get to the hotel and I get a phone call from the owner, and he says, hey Keith, my family and I are in town. We're going to come to chapel service. Just want to let you know, we're coming to the chapel service today. Now, I had already determined what I was going to do to the elephants that the owner had said he wanted the players to have. And so everyone said, well, are you still going to go through what you're going to go through with? Well, you all, I just felt like strongly I was supposed to give them the picture of what it meant to not just break something, but to smash it. And this referred to this sort of false god, pagan-based worship that had been given. And so sure enough, the owner and his wife and the kids came. I took out this golden glass elephant. I put it in a bag, and I said, this is what the Bible says you're supposed to do when you see these kinds of things. And I took the hammer, and I smashed the elephant in front of the owner and his and the team. And it's one
and
of
don't
the
work
few times.
Anymore.
No. It's one of the. It's one of the few times where actually we went to this game, and this was a game where we were losing immensely at halftime. Excuse my little glory stories at halftime. And I actually went into the locker room and I said, Father, if you could just somehow, some way, help us pull this out, because if we lose this one, it's going to be on me that I broke the good luck image. Well, it's one of the craziest games we ever had. It's in Denver, and we won the game. Now, I don't think it had anything to do with answered prayer, but boy, it sure took the pressure off me for smashing They're golden. They're
but again, the Hebrew language is really clear. It isn't just to simply break it, it's to smash it. And Amen. that's what Moses is saying. That's my story, and I'm sticking with it.
Amen.
Hey, so another word that it uses here, which is really significant in verse 3, mm-hmm. and we're not going to get out of chapter 12, I'm pretty sure, is the word to cut down their images. Mm. And the word is a word that really it means chop down, like to chop down a tree. Which is kind of an interesting word. And the reason it's interesting is that word could to Gadeon is from the same root as the name Gideon. And you could translate this to Gideon a tree. And why was Gideon called that? Well, later in his life, he actually chopped down the Asherah. You know, mm-hmm. Asherah is the mother of Baal. So you've got the statue here, which represents Baal, and you've got Asherah. And is that how they translated Asherah in verse 3? Or do you have like groves or something like that? Some translations have groves.
What do you got,
Pete? It's
got Ashrim. And then the NAS has Ashrim.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay, so I don't have that. In verse 3, I've got destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, burn their wooden images with fire, cut down their carved images of their gods, and destroy the names from that place.
Okay, so I think it's translating there as I didn't follow which one it was. But
maybe
it's
probably wooden images, I think, yeah.
Wooden images. Mm-hmm. But it's actually specifically Asherah, which is a goddess. Mm-hmm. And hence the statue that represents the goddess, and that's the mother of Baal. So Baal is the son, in the Canaanite pagan belief, was the son of the Most High God, creator of heaven and earth, who retired from his job as creator and left the universe to his son to rule, actually to several of his sons, and they fought it out in Baal won. Mm-hmm. And his mother, Asherah, was an important focus of worship. And so they would have the altar, and they would have a matseva, which is a stone image. Next to the stone image would be a tree. And sometimes they didn't have a tree. They just had the trunk of a tree or a pole because trees aren't very easy to get a hold of in Israel. So they would have some kind of pole representing a tree. And and that represented Asherah. And Gideon actually chopped down Asherah. And I actually want to look at that story if we can.
Yeah,
Before we get to the Gideon story, so I want to look in verse 5. It says, but only to the place where Yehovah chooses, your God chooses out of all your tribes to put his name there, to cause it to dwell, you will seek and you will come there. So we've got some really important – we've got three important concepts here. We've got the place Yehovah chooses. We've got the place he puts his name and the place he causes it to dwell. And those are essentially in one verse. We've got the three concepts that appear throughout the Tanakh. And really, they're essentially the same thing. The place he chooses is mentioned 25 times in the Tanakh. 23, it's actually mentioned in the future as the place he will choose. And twice, it's mentioned in the past tense as the place he did choose, which eventually became Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Then when he talks about placing his name, that appears 11 times in the Tanakh. And we'll look at one of those in a second. And then to cause his name to dwell, that appears 10 times in Tanakh. So this is something that appears repeatedly and is really a key concept. Can we read a few verses here that reference this? And the reason I bring it up is that it first appears here in Deuteronomy 12:5, and then it appears throughout this Torah portion, it appears numerous times. Mm-hmm. So can we read let's see. It says Chronicles 7:12, but I'm going to guess that's either 1 Chronicles or 2 Chronicles. So who's going to read that for me? Let's try 2 Chronicles 7:12.
Okay, hold on. And it says, let's see. Yehovah appeared unto him at night and said, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we've got the chosen place. That's 2 Chronicles 7:12. And the next one I want to look at is... The next one is the book that I wrote, the book of Nehemiah.
Hey, nice.
My namesake, Nehemiah, chapter 1, verse 9. Can someone read that?
It says, but if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the farthest parts of the heavens, goodness me, yet I will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. All right, hang on. Wait, I'm confused. Cast out to the furthest part of the heavens?
And that's actually a paraphrase of something in Deuteronomy.
Okay.
There are similar things in Deuteronomy 4 and I believe 30. And what that means is, presumably it's not meant literally, and it means just the farthest part of the earth. Because if you look over at the horizon, what do you see? You see the earth disappearing and the heavens continue. Mm-hmm. So symbolically, you know, when you're saying the farthest parts of the heavens, you mean the ends of the earth. Or maybe they mean some, you know, deep space colony 100 years from now. I don't know. But assuming they don't mean that, assuming there's not like a science fiction aspect to this, so presumably it means the farthest parts of the earth. And from there, I will gather them. And this is, you know, like I said, a paraphrase of a couple places in Deuteronomy. But here it's the past tense, which I have chosen to cause my name to dwell there. And the place is Jerusalem. Now, when he talks about in Deuteronomy, the place that he will choose, it doesn't necessarily mean one place for all time. What it means is wherever he chooses, when the cloud rises up and then goes to another place mm-hmm. and lands the next day, then that's the place that Jehovah chooses to place his name. But then in the time of Solomon, he chooses for all time Jerusalem. And we can read this in a couple of places. 2 Kings 21:7 says, it's talking about King Manasseh, and it says, and he was the most evil king of Judah. It says, he even the carved image of Asherah, that's our girl here, the mother of Baal in chapter 12 of Deuteronomy, even set up a carved image of Asherah that he had made in the house which Jehovah had sent to David and to Solomon, his son. In this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever. Say forever.
Forever.
Ever. Not just for a short period of time, but forever. So I believe Jehovah's name is there still. Once he chose that in the time of David and Solomon, that became the place of his name forever. Ezekiel 43:7 is talking about the end times. It says, and he said to me, son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place of the soles of my feet, where I will dwell in the midst of the children of Israel forever. Forever. I just sneezed. Hold on. I'm sitting surrounded by cat smells, which I'm allergic to. I'm going to die. All right. What I do for Torah pearls. Where I will dwell in the midst of the children of Israel forever, not for a short period of time, not for 500 years or 2,000 years, but forever. Mm-hmm. From the time that he chose Jerusalem and the temple in Jerusalem, even though that temple is destroyed, he still causes his holy name to dwell there. And that is a holy place to this day. Even though it's been defiled by people, it's still holy, and it needs to be treated as a holy place. And so this is actually not like some little trivial concept. It's a key concept, and it becomes key throughout this chapter, where we have this distinction between sacrificing in your gates, which means in one of your cities. That's an expression throughout Deuteronomy. In one of your gates means in one of your cities. And that's that's the opposite of the chosen place. I mean, really, so that's the way Deuteronomy describes it. There's the chosen place, and there's within one of your gates, which is anywhere away from the chosen place. And so that's key throughout this passage.
Amen. Judges chapter 6, verse 25, now it came to pass that same night that Jehovah said to him, take your father's young bull, the second bull, of 7 years old, and tear down the altar of Baal that your father has, and cut down the wooden images that is beside it, and build an altar to Jehovah your God on top of this rock in the proper arrangement, and take the second bull and offer as a burnt sacrifice and with the wood of the image which you shall cut down. So Gideon took 10 men from among the servants and did as Jehovah had said to him, but because he feared his father's household and the men of the city too much to do it by day, he did it by night. And when the men of the city arose early in the morning, there were the altars of Baal torn down, the wooden images that were beside it cut down, and the second bull was being offered on the altar which had been built. So they said to one another, who's done this thing? And then when they inquired, it said, Gideon, the son of Joash. He's done it. Mm-hmm. Good on him.
So Gideon came like a thief in the night.
He did.
How do you like that? And can you keep reading through verse 32?
And the men of the city said to Joash, bring out your son that he may die, because he has torn down the altar of Baal and because he has cut down the wooden images that was beside it. But Joash said to all who stood against him, would you plead for Baal? Would you save him? Let the one who would plead for him be put to death by mourning. If he is God, let him plead for himself, because his altar has been torn down. Excellent. Therefore, on that day, they called him Yerubbaal, saying, let Baal plead against him because he has torn down his altar.
Right, and Yerubal or Jerubal in English means let it's from the Hebrew Yaliv bo haBaal, let Baal plead with him, or actually I would translate it as strive with him, mm-hmm. mean to enter with him into an argument in court to bring charges against him. Let Baal bring charges against him. You don't have to do that. Baal can take care of himself. And so he's got two names that refer to this. One is his original name, which is Gideon, which means chopper. He chopped down the tree, and that's actually what his name alludes to. And then they give him this name Yerubal, let Baal strive with him. And there's a couple interesting things in this passage, because on the one hand, he's commanded to destroy the high place of Baal, but then Yehovah tells him to build an altar in its place, take the wood from the Asherah tree, and use it to burn the sacrifice. Mm. I mean, it's almost like it kind of reminds me of what they did in Egypt, where they took the lamb that people worship. They slaughtered the lamb in front of the eyes of the Egyptians and said, "You worship this lamb. We're going to show you our God's more powerful than lambs."
Amen.
And so here they took the wood of the Asherah tree and used her wood to burn the sacrifice. And but then it also to me is curious that God commanded him to build the altar, and that's because in verse 13 it says of Deuteronomy 12, if we go back to it, says, "Be careful for you, literally, or guard yourself, lest you offer a burnt offering in any place where you see, but only the place where Jehovah chooses out of one of your tribes. There you will offer your burnt offerings, and there you will do all that I command you." Mm. So in the case of Gideon, I think we can legitimately say that, you know, well, God obviously chose this place because he told Gideon to do that. But this is actually a question that you know, Jewish commentators have struggled with. Before the temple was built, people seem to be offering at these high places. And maybe we could pop over to Ezekiel chapter 20, and we won't read the whole thing, but maybe Keith can read verses 29, 32, and 39, and then I invite the people to read the rest of it themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Ezekiel 20, 29, 32, and 39.
Okay, so 29, "Then I said to them, what is this high place you go to? It is called Bama to this day," the Bama. And then what else?
Bama means high place. And mm-hmm. he was talking about when Israel first came into the land, they built these high places. And like I said, maybe we should go back to verse 28. It says, "And I brought them to the land which I lifted my hand to give to them," meaning I swore to give to them, "and they saw every high hill and every thick leaved tree, and they sacrificed there their offerings, and they gave there the anger of their sacrifices," meaning something that didn't please God, angered him. "And they placed there their sweet smells," or their pleasant smells, mm-hmm. and they poured out their libations. "And I said to them, what is this high place which you are coming there?" That's what it literally says. "And he called, and it was called," or their name was called, "Bama until this very day." So Bama is the Hebrew word for high place. And it's interesting because in every synagogue in the world, there's a raised platform where they do certain rituals on, especially they read the Torah from, and that's called a bima, from the same mm-hmm. word as bama, and it makes you wonder if there isn't, like, why is it a race platform? Why is it a high place? I don't know. Just some food for thought. Verse 32.
"You say, we want to be like the nations, like the peoples of the world, who serve wood and stone. But what you have in mind will never happen."
Exactly. So here, this is actually alluding to what he commanded them not to do in Deuteronomy 12. He commanded them, "Don't worship me the way the nations worship mm-hmm. Worship their gods." And what do they do? They say, "We want to be like the nations to worship, you know, to worship wood and stone." Mm-hmm. You know, I don't love Jehovah enough to build him a stone, you know, idol. I mean, what? The Canaanites love their gods more than I love my God? Come mm-hmm. on. We've got to honor him. We've got to build the statue. And this is exactly what he warned them not to do and exactly what they did. And then verse 39, there he brings it home. And again, I invite people to read the whole chapter. But verse 39.
"As for you, O house of Israel, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Go and serve your idols, every one of you. But afterward, you will surely listen to me and no longer profane my holy name with your gifts and idols."
Okay. And what do you got there, Jonah, in verse 39?
20:39. "As for you, O house of Israel, thus says Jehovah, Adonai Jehovah, go serve every one of you his idols. And hereafter, if you will not obey me, but profane my holy name no more with your gifts and your idols."
So what he's saying here is really, really interesting. He's saying, go worship your idols if you want, but don't bring me sacrifices. I don't want your sacrifices that you're bringing to the idol and saying that it's for me. Go worship the idols if you want, but leave me out of this. Stop right. desecrating my holy name by bringing sacrifices to the statue of Jehovah.
Keith, it sounds like you're saying either be hot or be cold, but don't be lukewarm, right?
Uh-oh, stay out of that.
Saying that's what it sounds like, right? Sounds I mean, like it's fair enough saying. To put it that way, I think.
Yeah, he's pushing them off the fence because they're saying, you know, we want our idols. We want our statues of wood and stone.
Yeah,
we want to honor Jehovah that way, the way the nations honor their gods. And he's saying, I don't want this. I told you what I want. If you're going to bring your sacrifices, knock yourselves out, but leave my holy name out of it.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
It's powerful stuff.
All right. Am I hitting on from 15?
Yeah. Wait, hold on. One second real quick. Oh, okay. So one other question, some food for thought here. So we've got this concept that there's really only one chosen place, and originally that's the tabernacle, and later that becomes the temple. Yes. Now remember, the tabernacle is mobile, so if God wants to say one day, okay, Gideon, go sacrifice on, you know, tear down that altar and sacrifice on top of this hill, he can do that. But once he chooses Jerusalem as the place, then presumably there's only one spot in the entire universe, which raises an interesting question, and I kind of started to talk about this before. So Jewish Bible commentators struggle with this question. They seem to be sacrificing all over the place before the temple was built. And so the explanation the rabbis offer is they say, well, the bamot, the high places, were actually permissible before the temple was built. That's what the rabbis say. That's not what I'm reading in Deuteronomy 12:13. 12:13 says, can you read 12:13 again in your translation, Jono?
12:13 says that take heed to yourself that you do not offer your burnt offerings in every place that you see, but the place where Jehovah chooses in your tribes, there you shall offer burnt offerings, and there you shall do all that I command you.
Ooh, and it actually, and this may be a Torah pearl, it says, but the place where Jehovah chooses in one of your tribes.
Ah, you're right, in one of your tribes, yeah.
Oh, that's what you have to? Yeah. Okay. So, one of your, that's important. There's one chosen place. And we read back in Leviticus 17 that if you bring a sacrifice and it's not to the place of the entrance of the tent of meeting, it's as if you shed blood.
Mm.
And he explained, he says, you know, don't, you know, they were bringing sacrifices on the fields. And he's saying, no, you've got to bring it to the entrance of the tent of meeting, not just wherever you want. Mm-hmm. And so this rabbinical interpretation kind of doesn't seem consistent with what we're reading here. And I understand where they're coming from, though. They're trying to explain why is it that Gideon did it on top of that hill. And Samuel seems to be sacrificing all these different places. And my explanation is that, well, the tabernacle was mobile, and maybe the structure didn't necessarily move each time, but God could choose different places for sacrifice. Where it gets really hairy, and no one really has a satisfactory answer. Like, you know, I've said before, sometimes the answers are more important than the questions. And that's when it comes to Elijah. So God tells Elijah to go up to Mount Carmel and offer sacrifices there. And that's when there's a temple in Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
That's after the time of David and Solomon, when Jehovah chose.
Look, I don't understand the confusion. Jehovah can do what he wants when he wants.
Okay. But I believe he's not. I mean, I don't disagree with you, but he does say that he chooses that place forever, and he talks about the place out of all the tribes of Israel. And now, well, there's one on Mount Carmel and one on Mount Zion. I don't know.
It's certainly thought provoking. There's no doubt about it, and it's obviously a topic that has caused many to be deep in consideration regarding these passages. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think what is obvious is that Elijah was doing this because he had to. You know, he was challenging the prophets of Baal, and they weren't going to come to the temple in Jerusalem. I mean, that was in a different country.
True.
They were in the kingdom of Israel, and Jerusalem was in the kingdom of Judah. So he had to meet them on their territory and challenge them in their territory.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he had to meet them where they were.
And again, specifically with this particular example, of course, as Keith pointed out, Jehovah said, hey, go and do it like this, do this, this is how we're going to do it, and you watch how I respond. My goodness, it's going to happen.
Right.
Amen.
Right. So, and the fact that he sent the fire down, you know, maybe that obviously confirms that he was doing the right thing, but it does raise the question, you know, how is it that we explain this? And
how is it to be understood? Yeah, absolutely. So no sacrifice outside of the place where he puts his name. However, in verse 15, you may slaughter and eat meat. It's not as if you're not allowed to, you know, slaughter an animal and eat meat. It's just if you're sacrificing to me, there's a place to do it, right? If you slaughter an e-meat within all, you can do it within your gates, whatever your heart desires, according to the blessing of Yehovah your God, which he has given you. The clean and the unclean may eat of it, the gazelle and the deer alike. Only you shall not eat the blood. You shall pour it out on the earth like water. You may not eat within your gates the tithe of your grain or the new wine or the oil, the firstborn of your herd or your flock, or any of the offerings which you vow, of your free will offering or of the heave offering of your hand. But you must eat them before Yehovah your God in the place which Yehovah your God chooses. You and your son, your daughter, your male and your female servants, and the Levite who is within your gates, and you shall rejoice before Yehovah your God to do in all to which you put your hand. Take heed to yourself that you do not forsake the Levite as long as you live in your land. When Yehovah your God enlarges your borders as he has promised you, and you say, "Let me eat meat," because you long to eat meat, and boy, don't I, you may eat as much meat as your heart desires. If the place where Yehovah your God chooses to put his name is too far from you, then you may slaughter from the herd and from the flock which Yehovah has given you, just as I have commanded you, and you may eat within your gates as much as your heart desires. Just as the gazelle and the deer are eaten, so you may eat them. The unclean and the clean alike may eat them. Only be sure that you do not eat the blood, for the blood is the life. You may not eat the life with the meat. You shall not eat it, shall pour it out on the earth like water. You shall not eat it. Boy, there's some emphasis on that. That it may go well with you and your children after you, when you do what is right in the sight of Yehovah. Only the holy things which you have and your vowed offerings you shall take and go to the place which Yehovah chooses, and you shall offer your burnt offerings and the meat and the blood on the altar of Yehovah your God, and the blood of the sacrifices shall be poured out on the altar of Yehovah your God, and you shall eat the meat. Observe and obey all these words which I command you, that it may go well with you and your children after you forever, when you do what is good and right in the sight of Yehovah your God.
Amen. All right. Thanks for reading the whole chapter, Jonah.
Hey, almost there.
Cool.
Actually, no, that's right. We've already done that bit. Yeah,
yeah, we read those other verses. So I think we talked about this in a previous section, probably when we did Leviticus 17, although I think we did this in like a separate program. Mm-hmm. Is that right, Jonah? I don't know. Anyway, so what he's talking about in verses 15 to 16 of Deuteronomy 12, and then again in verses 21 and 22 and 23, is or even in 20, is this issue that exactly what I just mentioned about Leviticus 17. In Leviticus 17, it says whenever if you bring a sacrifice and you don't bring it to the tent of meeting, it says if you spill blood. And actually, what it says if you ever slaughter a goat, a sheep, or a bull, it has to be brought as a sacrifice. And in other words, all meat that they ate in the desert that was a goat, a bull, or a sheep had to be a sacrifice. If they wanted to have a burger, they had to bring it as a sacrifice. And there's consequences to that. You have to be in a state of ritual purity if you're bringing a sacrifice. And so verses 15 to 16 is establishing essentially a rule which didn't apply in the desert, because in the desert, everybody was surrounding this little camp. Everyone was camped around this one central location. Mm-hmm. And he's talking about when you come to the land, well, then when you want to want to eat meat, you can eat it in your gates, meaning away from the chosen place. That's what the phrase in all of your gates means, meaning it's somewhere far away from the chosen place. And he reiterates that in verse 20. You can eat it in one of your gates. And then he says the clean and the unclean. And that doesn't mean you're eating an unclean animal. It means the person who's eating it is unclean. And that's important because, remember, a sacrifice can only be eaten by somebody who's ritually clean, meaning if you touched a dead body, you can't go and eat a sacrifice, whereas you can eat meat in one of your gates as long as it's not at the chosen place. Mm-hmm. And then he says he will eat it like the gazelle and the deer. Why is that important? Because gazelle and deer, even in the desert, they were allowed to eat those as non-sacrifices, because mm-hmm. gazelle and deer can't be brought as sacrifices. They're not species that are valid for sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And then he says, only don't eat the blood, pour it on the ground like water. Why pour it on the ground like water? As opposed to catching it and pouring it on the altar. And that's something that he refers to in verse 27. He says, okay, but if you're going to bring burnt offerings and other kinds of offerings, the blood of your offerings shall be poured upon the altar of Yehovah your God, and you may eat the flesh. So pour the blood on the altar and eat the flesh of sacrifices, of non-sacrifices. Just pour out the blood, get rid of it, don't use it for a ritual mm-hmm. purpose, and then you can eat the meat.
Amen. Amen. Chapter 13, Keith. give us chapter 13. Take us from verse 1.
I only want to say one thing, and this is really interesting. But just before we get to 13, and this was something we're going to experience when we go to Israel, Jono, and for those who come also. And it's kind of an obscure thing, but it's an important thing regarding this idea of where he set his name. In Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 12, and it says, "But go ye now into the place which was in Shiloh," or Shiloh, "where I set my name at the first, and see what I did to it for the wickedness of my people Israel." Mm-hmm. And there's this really powerful picture of this idea of where this idea of him setting his name. And to go to this place, it's kind of like the situation that Nehemiah mentioned with Mount Ebal, where you actually can go to a place and see the ruins of a spot where the Israelites were. Mm-hmm. And here's this spot, obviously, where the people at one point in the history, after they came into the land, where the people came and they brought their sacrifices and they came three times a year. And this idea of his setting his name forever, obviously we know where that is in Jerusalem. But, and I'm not trying to be overly spiritual, but this really is a powerful thing. The thought of going to a place that you can physically go to where he decided his name would be. And I'm telling you today, Jonah, we'll do a show from this spot for the world to listen to. You can sense something in this place. You literally can. Maybe I'm, like I said, it could be the.
We're gonna do a show, Sheila. I want to make be clear so I can hold you to it.
We're certainly gonna try.
Oh my goodness.
Okay.
We're certainly gonna try. But the reason I'm bringing it up is again the significance, and I'm glad, Nehemiah, that we took the time to talk about this regarding where he places his name and the idea of the sacrifices and these sorts of things, because I think we have to understand the gift that we have. That even today that we're able, and this really goes back to, again, an earlier portion that we talked in, Exodus chapter 20, verse 24, this first idea when Moses is talking to the people, and I just want to bring this verse really quick, and then we can move on to 13. But in Exodus 20, 24, where it says, if I can read it, it's talking about idols and altars, and it says, "Make an altar," in verse 20, 24, "make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep and your goats and your cattle." And then it's like this verse that just seems like it's not connected, but it's definitely connected. He says, "And wherever I cause my name to be honored," in my NIV, or mentioned in the Hebrew, "I will come to you and bless you." So this concept of the altar, and why this is so important, you guys, and those that are listening, is that what did the people end up doing? It wasn't just that they were searching after other gods, and that certainly was major. That's a major issue. But they're basically taking this idea of him saying, "Now, when you build the altar, I'm going to cause my name to dwell there, and this is what you're supposed to do with your offerings, and this is what you're supposed to do with your sacrifices." They set that apart. They move that aside, and they say, "Now we're going to call on another false god, and then we're going to call on another false god. We're going to go to an altar, and we're going to build an altar. We're going to build an ard thing. We're going to do our thing," and it's just like an affront to the creator of the universe, who says, "Here's my name. I'm going to cause my name to dwell here, and I'm going to come to you and bless you. Nah, we won't take that blessing. We'd rather be cursed." Jeremiah 7, verse 12. I hope that we go to this spot. I don't know how we're going to do it, but you mark it on your calendar. We're going to find a way to get there.
I'm going to bring my camos. Okay.
Yeah, excellent.
I'm looking forward to it.
I want to point out that in the English, what they list as 12:32, in the Hebrew is 13:1. So all the verses in Hebrew are one verse, I guess, one verse higher,
okay,
one verse difference, right? And that's important, right? Because he says, "All the matter that I command you, that I command it, you shall diligently do. You shall not add to it, and you shall not diminish from it." Mm-hmm. And certainly the traditional Jewish interpretation is that this is then it's connected to the previous section, obviously, but it's also connected to the following section, which deals with the false prophet.
Excellent point. Amen. Excellent.
So I'll read this. "If a prophet or one who foretells by dreams appears among you and announces to you a miraculous sign or wonder, and if the sign or wonder of which he has spoken takes place and he says, 'Let us follow other gods, gods who have not, we have not known, and let us worship them,' you must not listen to the words of that prophet or dreamer. Yehovah your God is testing you." I love that when he says that. "To find out whether you love him with all your heart, with all your soul. It is Yehovah your God you must follow, and him you must revere. Keep his commands and obey him, serve him and hold fast to him. That prophet or dreamer must be put to death because he preached rebellion against Yehovah your God, who brought you out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. He has tried to turn you from the way that Yehovah your God commanded you to follow. You must purge the evil from among you."
Mm.
pretty amazing that he tests them, but that he says, if this thing were, this prophet or this dreamer comes and says, "Hi, I've got a new revelation. I've got some gold tablets that say that this is what we're supposed to do," or "I've got a new revelation. I found out that this is the new revelation that as I was, you know," I mean, whatever it is, if you find yourself being turned away from the creator of the universe, then that's a test. And it doesn't just say that it happens. It says, but that's a test from him. Our Father says, "I'm going to test you." And you know what? There are a lot of people, unfortunately, today, Jono and Nehemiah, who have failed this test because they have gone after other gods.
I think this is pretty radical that we've got a standard here that Moses is giving us. Because look, Moses, he's unquestionable. You know, 3 million Israelites, 600,000 men, and the rest of the Israelites all heard God speaking out of the fire, and that confirmed that Moses was a true prophet. And you know, because after that they said, "Okay, well, you just go and you talk to him for us, because we can't do this directly." Mm-hmm. So we got no question about Moses, and he's telling us, "Okay, here's the standard from henceforth: don't add and don't take away." And if somebody tells you to worship another god, remember before we saw before that one of the standards or the two choices are the blessing and the curse. And the blessing is worship Yehovah and keep his commandments, and the curse is if you don't follow the commandments, then you're worshiping a different god. Mm-hmm. And that's here right. He's saying if you get a prophet who comes and tells you to worship a different god and adds or takes away from the commandments, then, you know, because if he adds or takes away from the commandments, that's a different god, then don't listen to him, because that's Yehovah testing you. I think that's profound.
Even if he gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder comes to pass.
Genuine signs and miracles. That's pretty impressive. Mm. And we actually, I know in Jewish history, we've got a number of examples of people like this, and probably the most famous one for Jews is Shabtai Tzvi, who was accepted as the Messiah by really the entire Jewish world, or I should say people throughout the Jewish world accepted him as the Messiah in, I believe it was 1648. And one of the things he taught, the dead giveaway that he wasn't the true Messiah, is that he said, "God has canceled the commandments. We no longer have to keep them." And that was the dead giveaway. People heard that and they said, "This guy isn't the Messiah. We can move on now."
Amen.
There it is.
If your brother or the son of your mother or the son of your daughter, the wife of your...
Jono, I'm going to ask that you not read this section. This is entirely too controversial for you to read this section. Can we just move to 12?
This is not one that you preach from the pulpit on a Sunday morning, is it, Keith? I mean, I've never heard this on a Sunday morning. I mean, if someone...
It's a feel-good passage.
Well, it says, you know, if even your relative says, "Let us go and serve other gods, which you have not known, neither you nor your fathers or the gods of the people which are around you, near or far off from you, the end of the earth," and so on and so forth, blah, blah, blah. It says, Keith, this is what it says.
Wait, does it say blah, blah, blah?
Thank you for the blah, blah, blah. I appreciate that. Go ahead.
That's the New King James Version, people. Blah, blah, blah.
I'm trying to move it along. Keith, it says, your eyes shall not pity him, nor shall you spare him, nor conceal him, but you shall surely kill him. Your hand shall be first against him to put him to death, and afterwards the hand of all the people. You shall stone him with stones until he dies, because he sought to entice you away from Yehovah your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. So Israel shall hear and fear,
This is why, Jonah, I didn't want you to read this section, because if we read this section, we can ask the question, okay, so maybe we're not talking about putting someone to death in our society. Maybe we're talking about something different. But I think that the concept is clear. And the concept that is clear is that if even your closest friend secretly entices you, even if it be your daughter or your son, and this is the hard one, or your wife, and says, "Let us go and worship other gods, gods of the people around us. Let's just be like the nations around us. Come on, let's don't take this so serious. It's no big deal. So we want to do this." I mean, and the issue is that this is a difficult passage, because, okay, someone could say, "Well, are you gonna stone that person?" But I think it'd be pretty clear that when it comes to someone saying, "Let us go worship other gods," that there is a real clear a sense of that's not going to happen for the person that understands who Yehovah is and who they've been called to be and what it means to worship him. And that's why I said this is a controversy, because I think there's a lot of people who listen to this show, and I want to send this shout out to them. I think there's a lot of people who listen to this show that have had people very close to them that have tried to say, look, you're taking this entirely too serious, this one God Yehovah thing. I mean, you're taking it too serious. You've got to open the door to the other possibilities, the other options. And I'm not even talking about Christianity here. I'm talking about, you can just walk down the street. And I won't go down this road. But there are just many, many times when people will come and say, look, you're taking it entirely too serious. You know, one God, that limits us. There are many gods. Here's your option. And unfortunately, that isn't just from the outsider. Sometimes it's the people that are very close to you.
Mm. Fair enough.
Can I also, I mean, look, I also want to, I hope nobody's listening to this and saying, oh, okay, I've got to now divorce my husband or my wife because I figured something out that they didn't know, you know, that they don't know, something I didn't know last week, but know it this week, right. And now I've got to. So I want to make it clear that I don't know what Keith is saying, but I'm definitely not saying that. And I think one thing we need to remember is what it's talking about here is a situation where everyone is worshiping the true God. And then we've got one person who steps out of line and tries to entice somebody away. Mm. And throughout most of the period of the Bible, this you know, these commandments, this particular commandment was never implemented because not only was it, you know, it wasn't a matter of, you know, the one person who stepped out of line. 99% of the people were out of line, and you got the one, you know, 1% of the people who were actually following the truth. And so they never actually had the opportunity to implement this commandment. It's more of like an ideal, I think, what's being raised up here. And, you know, I think another model to look at is Abraham. You know, Abraham is a really interesting character because, I mean, think about Abraham begins to follow God, the God of Israel. And we don't know exactly how old he is, but what we do know is he comes to the land of Israel when he's 75. And when does God tell him to get circumcised? Do you remember? It's when he's 86, 11 years later. So he goes 11 years before he's really ready for the full commitment. And I think that's a lesson for us that, you know, there might be people who – and I think for all of us it's a journey – And what I want to urge people to do is to remember that, you know, very few of us were born knowing all the truth. I think for most of us, we're on a journey. And, you know, if somebody is in a different place in the journey, you know, be like God was to Abraham. You know, have the patience. You know, God had the patience and said, okay, I'm going to wait 11 years until you're ready. When you're ready, then I'll give you this commandment. I'm not going to give it to you before you're ready.
But, Jono, this one's for you. This is for you, Jono. So that's Nehemiah's nice guy shtick, okay? That's his nice guy shtick. But, Jono, if somebody comes and whispers in your ear and
Keith, come on with that.
They come and whisper in your ear and say, Jono, come on, let's worship false gods. Look, pick up one of those Australian stones and hit him in the head. Jono, you're a legitimate warrior. We're going to go in there and we're going to scout out the land. And if we see some altar that's to a false god, we're breaking
it
down.
Smash it down.
I get an amen. We're going to do it on truth.
Amen.
And we'll have Nehemiah come and fix it for us.
You know,
I'm bailing you out.
You're bailing us out. But, you know, when I read this, guys, I put myself in the position back in the day and I thought, you know, imagine if my brother or my sister or one of my close relatives came to me and said, hey, you know what, over there, the people who were here before, they used to – and we just found over there there's one of those altars, and why don't we go and try that? Because, you know, and the absolute fear of hearing something like that, you know, you don't even want to hear it because it says, you know, you shall not pity him. You know, you won't hide him. You can't spare him. If you hear something like that from then, you've got to knock him off. Not only that, but in verse 12, Keith, it says, if you hear someone in one of your cities, which Jehovah gives you to dwell in, saying, corrupt men have gone out from among you and enticed the inhabitants of the city, saying, let us go and serve other gods.
Stop here. Because it's for me, verse 14, I think for you, verse 13, where it talks corrupt men. What do you got there instead of corrupt men, Keith?
Wicked men.
Wicked men. And what does the Hebrew say? The Hebrew says, B'nai Beliya'al, sons of Beliya'al. And that's a really interesting concept. This is the first time it appears in the Tanakh, Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 14. It's the first time we're hearing about Beliya'al. And Beliya'al is a word that in Hebrew they translate as without yoke, beli'ol. It's actually essentially sort of a compound word. And so men who are without yoke, and they're without the yoke of the Torah. And the reason that's interesting is I guess I'm kind of pitching a softball here to Keith because I've heard him preach on this, and so I'm going to invite him to do that. If he remembers, he's got a whole thing about that in the New Testament.
Yeah, 2 Corinthians 6:15. When you hang out with those unyoked, you know, don't hang out with those that are without yoke. And I think it's 2 Corinthians 6:15. Paul says, "In what concord hath Christ with Belial?" is the word that he uses in the New Testament. And if you do a little search, what you can find is that word that's used there is actually, if you go into the Septuagint, you'll find that this is the word that's also used for the very words that Nehemiah just talked about, the children, the sons of Belial. And so who are these people? These are the people that would tell you, let us find a way to leave the God of Israel and let us go after other gods. And so we did this open door series, Jonah, which really is this was just one of the many things that we did, the teachings that came up. And this was one because I had received a letter that said, hey, what are you doing hanging out with this guy, Nehemiah Gordon? You guys, you're unequally yoked. You're not yoked together. And that kind of led me to this of digging into 2 Corinthians 6 and see what Paul was saying. And what Paul was really saying, if I get to the actual language history and context, refers right back to this particular verse that we're in. So that's why I'm kind of glad that Nehemiah brought it up in 12:3, because what is it that these guys are saying in Deuteronomy 12:3, Nehemiah? What are they saying?
It says, let us go and let us worship other gods whom you have not known. And that's essentially the definition of B'nai Belial. They're children who are without yoke. They're saying, okay, we're not yoked by the Torah, which tells us to worship the one true God. We're going to go worship other gods. And I think what you're trying to say, Keith, if I'm understanding you, and by the way, Belial, that's the only place in the entire New Testament that it appears in 2 Corinthians 6:15, even though in the Hebrew Tanakh it appears 27 times, the word Belial without yoke. I think, you know, if you read the, you know, and here this is me speaking as not as a Christian, but just as a textual scholar, I'm looking, reading, you know, a text in context. I know how to read. If you read 2 Corinthians 6, that section in context, he's actually talking to, you know, he's talking about how they were fellowshipping with these pagan Greeks. And what he, you know, and he says later on, and what agreement has the temple of God with idols? You know, he's talking about people who are supposed to be worshiping the one true God, who are interacting with these pagan Greeks. He's saying, hey, you know, these are men of Belial. These are men who are telling us to go worship other gods. We've got to worship the true God. We can't go worship other gods.
It's Paul who's telling us to quit hanging out with the pagan Greeks. It's Paul who's telling us that.
That's what he says.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's Paul who also says on a number of occasions, I think.
Paul's got a bad rap, Keith. Is that what you're saying?
What I'm telling you is that if you read this situation, Paul says, hey, don't hang out with those folks. But that's another conversation. That's for the more radical truth to you.
and he mentions, you know, purge the evil from among you is something else that Paul also reiterates. And we read that a lot. And it says here that you shall go to that, you will surely strike the inhabitants of that city with the edge of the sword, destroy it and all that is in it, even its livestock, with the edge of the sword. And you shall gather its plunder into the middle of the street and completely burn it with fire in the city and its plunder. For Yehovah your God, it shall be a heap forever. It shall not be built again. None of the accursed things shall remain in your hand, that Yehovah may turn from the fierceness of his anger and show you mercy and have compassion on you and multiply you as he swore to your fathers, because you have listened to the voice of Yehovah your God to keep all his commandments, which I command you today, to do what is right in the eyes of Yehovah your God. Now,
you know, what's interesting is as far as I know, this has never actually been implemented, this commandment of wiping out a whole city, but it almost was implemented once, and that was towards the end of Joshua, and I'm sure you read this with Yoel, in your series, Light of the Prophets. Yeah. So there's a situation there where the people in Transjordan, they build themselves, you know, they got the 2.5 tribes in Transjordan, and they build themselves an altar. And the other tribes hear this, and they say, an altar? Well, we've got the tabernacle. You can't have an altar. That must be an altar to another god. And there's almost a civil war in which they come and try to carry this out and wipe out those other tribes. And then they find out, well, it's not actually an altar. It's more of a testimony, essentially. Mm-hmm. It's not an altar for sacrifices. It's more of a symbolic altar to as a testimony that the 2.5 tribes are connected to all the other tribes and they're one people. So, there but this was almost carried out in that situation. But as far as I know, it was never actually carried out.
Yeah, they were keen, but it didn't happen. So, now chapter 14. Before we get to clean and unclean, just the first couple of verses here. You are the children of Yehovah your God. You shall not touch yourself.
I gotta stop you.
Okay.
So it doesn't say among you are the children. What do you got, Keith?
Let's see here. It says, you are the
children. Well, I'm going to let you read the first two verses, and then I'm going to stop you.
You are the children of Yehovah your God. You shall not cut yourselves nor shave the front of your head for the dead. For you are holy people to Yehovah your God, and Yehovah has chosen you to be a people for him, a special treasure above all peoples who are on the face of the earth.
Chosen people. So in my Hebrew, it says, Banim atem la Yehovah Elohechem, which I guess you could translate as you are children of Yehovah your God. But literally it says you are sons of Yehovah your God. And I got to ask a question, you know, what does that mean, you are sons of Yehovah your God? I think, imagine if somebody came down from the planet Mars or, you know, I don't know, out of the outback of Australia, who didn't know anything
about... Because those two places are kind of similar.
They really are. Who didn't know anything about the, about, you know, the Judeo-Christian concepts. You know, and this is the first verse they read in the Bible. You are sons of Yehovah your God, they read. And they didn't know anything. They know Yehovah's God, and they know you are sons. What would they understand here? What do you think they'd understand? And I wonder if they wouldn't – yeah.
But you I wonder if they would, that was somehow like the descendants, like physical descendants of the
– Right. They might actually say literally you are sons of Yehovah your God. And so I asked the question, what does it really mean – you are sons of Yehovah your God? And, you know, look, I mean, God is the father of all mankind. Mm-hmm. So what does it mean that Israel is the sons of God? And I think the answer is in the second verse where it says, you are a holy nation to Yehovah your God. Mm-hmm. You, Yehovah, has chosen to be for him a treasured people out of all the nations. So I think to be a son of Yehovah means to be chosen. And I can actually prove that with another verse, which is 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 6, where we hear about a certain individual who is the Son of God. Now, did you know that the Son of God is mentioned in the Old Testament, Keith?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
My word. Let me see.
He's on every page, isn't it?
Now he said to me, it is your son, Solomon, who shall build my house and my courts, for I have chosen him to be my son, and I will be his father. Moreover, I will establish his kingdom forever, if he is steadfast to observe my commandments and my judgments as it is this day.
Okay, so here Jehovah is saying he chooses Solomon as his king, and in that sense, Solomon is the son of God. It says it right there. I have chosen him to be my son, and
yeah.
I will be his father. And I think, in a sense, that's a picture of Messiah. And I'm speaking as a Jew about this, meaning mm-hmm. I think the future Messiah, when he comes, will be the son of God, in that Yehovah will choose him. And you could say, well, God chooses all of Israel, and that's true. But to be a son of God means to be chosen, and the Messiah is chosen as one of the people, but he's chosen even in a more special way. So mm-hmm. he's the son of God. In the way that maybe all of Israel is the son of God and all God's people are his children, but he's, you know, in an even more special way, he's the son of God. And but I think we have, you know, both elements, both in Deuteronomy 14, 1 through 2 and 1 Chronicles 28, 6, we've got being chosen and being a son of God. Those two things essentially are the same concept. To be holy, to be chosen, you know, because holy means to be set apart and above. So in that sense, it's connected to being chosen.
So just a second. You used the word. First, you started out and you said Solomon, the. You used the word the. Then you switched and said a son of God. Which are you saying?
Well, Solomon is obviously a son of God, that makes him the son of God. The reason I said the is that he is a son in a more special way than all of Israel is the sons of God. Right. In other words. 14:1 in Deuteronomy is saying, you, Israel, are sons of Yehovah, your God. And 1 Chronicles 28:6 is identifying him as even more of a son.
Or this is, you shall go to Pharaoh. Thus says Yehovah, Israel is my son, my firstborn. So I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. But if you refuse to let him go, I indeed will kill your son, your firstborn.
For I brought my son out of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but the point is that we have Israel as a nation being Yehovah's son, and in 1 Chronicles 28:6, we actually have an individual within Israel who is specifically the son. And what does that mean? It means he's the king, and in that sense, the Messiah, who will be the king of Israel,
will be
the son of God.
Amen. Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen. Yes. Amen. Absolutely.
Yehovah will choose him as his son.
Solomon is a foreshadowing.
Amen. You shall not eat any detestable thing. Now, we did go into some considerable detail, if I remember correctly. Now, actually, before we go on to that, we have to deal with the you shall not cut yourselves or shave the front of your head for the dead. Are we going to touch on that?
I wish people would read the context of that.
Mm.
Three words in English, for the dead.
For the dead. For the dead. Leviticus 19:27. We touched on it briefly. Did you want to add anything to that?
Well, so they can. I refer people to my study on karaitecorner.org, karaite-corner, corner with a K.org, where I talk about the whole issue of shaving. And I reference this and all the other evidence, and we don't need to rehash that.
We don't have to do that again. And as for clean and unclean, we did go through that in some considerable detail in Leviticus chapter 11 in that Torah portion. Do we want to
I want to say something. I just want to say something. One of the things that I do like, Jono, is that you give the chapter that we did go over, because I do think, and we can talk about this, but I do think it's really, really helpful for those that are studying this. And this is a discipline, but to basically get as much information as you can, compare all that information, and then you're able to kind of come up with what it is that you see that the Torah is saying. So we can talk about it now, but also to refer to that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I think verse 3, the opening verse of you know, essentially Deuteronomy 14:1-2 is its own section, and then verse 3 begins the section on edible and inedible things, and I think verse 3, that opening verse, is so key. Can you read that for us?
You shall not eat any detestable thing.
No. What do you got, Keith?
You shall not eat any detestable thing.
Come on, that's really what your says.
That's what I got.
Can we find a translation that captures the spirit of this verse? I mean, I think this is there's an agenda here. I'm telling you, there's an agenda here in this translation. The JPS Jewish Publication Society says you shall not eat anything abhorrent. I want to do something real quick. So Leviticus 18:22 has the same exact word as in Deuteronomy 14:3. Leviticus 18:22. The King James Version says, I'll just read you the end of the verse.
It is abomination.
Same word as in Deuteronomy 14:3, abomination. That's an abomination, and people could read that verse themselves, Leviticus 18:22. We want this program to be able to be broadcast in Canada, and where they don't have freedom of speech.
What you're saying is that you shall not eat any abominable thing, right? That's what you're suggesting. Now, this is an interesting thing, because that's what it says. So in 13 verse 14, what do you have in 13:14? Is that the same word? Deuteronomy 13:14.
Yeah, same word, abomination. What do you got there?
There it is. I've got abomination here. It's the same word, and it's only a few verses later, and they change the word piece.
13, and here in 14, it doesn't have that. Why is that? Because they don't want us to equate eating a pig with the thing that it describes in Leviticus 18, or worshiping idols. And in the Torah terms, all three of those things are abominations.
Wow.
And I think it's interesting that you can get all kinds of people to get behind, no pun intended, the other issue. But when it comes to eating this, all of a sudden, well, no, that's been done away with. We don't have to worry about that. And I think that's kind of hypocrisy.
That blows my mind. Keith, there's another good – Keith, what have you got in – just curiously, what does the NIV have in 13:14? Does it use the word abomination, or have you got detestable – what do you got there?
I want to stop the show. And what I want to ask – no, I want to stop the show. Everyone, please just bear with us for a second. So Nehemiah, you're the pig police.
I'm not pig police. I'm just saying what God said. Eat as much pig as you want. Well, that's between you and God. I just want us to know, if you're going to eat the pig, know what God says about it. Because the translations are trying to hide it from you. Know what God says. Eat pig until you get yourself a coronary. You know, that's between you and your creator. Really, I could care less. My point is, know what God says about it and then make your decision. I want to empower people with information. What they do with that information, that's up to them. They could say, you know what? This abomination was done away with because of such and such theology. It no longer applies. Back then it was an abomination. Now it's okay. And look, there's people who say, who you know what? I have respect for the people who can say that Leviticus 18, that's no longer an abomination. That was done away with, just like Deuteronomy 14. I don't agree with them, but at least they're internally consistent. So it's not that I'm the pig police. I'm saying let's be internally consistent here. Let's not say one was done away with and the other one still applies. You know, if you're going to say, well, anything goes and we can, you know, worship Vishnu and God doesn't really care and he still loves us. He loves everybody. You know, fine. You know, that at least you're consistent. But if you're going to say, okay, well, we can't worship idols and we can't do what Leviticus 18 says, but we're allowed to eat pig, then, you know, I mean, I see an inconsistency there.
You know why you wanted to stop? Speaking of consistency, I've just, because Keith wouldn't answer my question, so I had to grab my own NIV and open it up. 13:14 in the NIV says, then you must inquire, probe, and investigate it thoroughly, and if it is true, if it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done among you. Point for the New King James, once again.
I didn't want you to see that.
What does the NIV have in Leviticus 18?
It's consistent. It has detestable thing for both verses.
Oh, detestable thing. Okay.
At least the New King James is half correct. We got one verse, not the other.
Exactly. So we've got
ladies and gentlemen, I just want you to know, really, Torah Pills is all about pitting the New King James against the Methodist Bible.
The NIV.
Yes.
The NIV.
Well, we've been uncovered, ladies and gentlemen, so we need
There's
to move
on. Point. Hey, don't think I don't have a tally going on here. I'm not in the studio, Keith, believe me. Now, you shall not eat. Now, it says... let me go to 21. You shall not eat anything.
Oh, 21. What?
Wait,
okay. We're going to go back, right? I mean,
what do you want?
We got a lot of important things here. So first of all, Leviticus, what was it? Leviticus 11, mm-hmm. The section that we read in. And what Torah portion was that, Jono? Can you remind the people?
That was called something by the name of, okay. Ladies and gentlemen, just a reminder to everybody that truthtoyou.org. If you go there, you click on Torah Pearls, and every single one of these programs from the beginning of the Torah portion right to the very end of the year, which we're rapidly approaching, it's there for you to download freely and to listen to anytime you so desire. It is Leviticus 11 is Shmini.
Okay.
Shmini.
So we talked about that in Shmini. Yeah. And in Leviticus 11, when it talked about these laws of what you may eat and what you may not eat, it also talked about a second subject, which is what you may touch and what you may not touch. And if you touch certain things that you're allowed to touch, there still may be consequences to those things, which is you become ritually unclean. And then, of course, you can't then interact with the temple or with any of the mm-hmm. temple sacrifices. Remember, in the desert, they couldn't have a hamburger if they were ritually unclean, mm-hmm. and, you know, unless it was from a gazelle. Or a deer, but they couldn't have a beef burger if they were ritually unclean. Deuteronomy 14 doesn't talk about that at all. It only talks about what you're not allowed to eat and what you're allowed to eat, with one exception, and that's in verse 8. And so I think for that reason, it's worth reading verse 8. And
also,
as the pig police, I will read this verse.
Go on.
And the pig, for it splits its hoof, but it does not chew its cud. It is unclean for you. Their flesh you will not eat, and their carcass you will not touch. Mm-hmm. Doesn't say that for any of the other animals except for this category of animals that has one of the signs and not one of the other. Remember, the two signs mm-hmm. are split mm-hmm. hoof and chew its cud. Yep. If they've got one and not the other, not only are you forbidden from eating it, you're also forbidden from touching it. And that only applies to this very limited set of things. And that was also something we saw in Leviticus 11, that there were all kinds of animals that if you touch them, you become unclean, but it's not forbidden to touch them. Mm. Whereas for the pig, you're actually forbidden from touching its carcass. So score one for the pig police. And look, I really am not the pig police. I really have nothing against somebody who wants to eat pig and, you know, until they have a heart attack. You know, that's really, like I said, between them and God. I love those people. I love all people. I even love the homosexuals. And
I'm a loving, fun-loving guy.
I'm saying that for the record. I really do. I just want people to be empowered with information and to know what God has to say about how they live their lives. Anyway, so and that may need to be edited out for the Canadian version.
What it says and abide by it. So now, you know, it's an interesting thing. I remember discovering I came across a list of Christian Bibles that were bound with pig leather. Blows my mind.
Wow.
Anyway, moving along. All right, where are we going with this?
Can we talk about what – does Keith have anything to add about that? Or
Keith?
No, I'm whatever.
Speechless.
Let's move on.
Yes, I made Keith speechless. All right. I want to talk about Deuteronomy 14, verse 13, which I think is the most interesting verse in the entire Torah portion. It's the most important, most interesting.
Deuteronomy 14, verse
13.
Verse 13. Okay, so it says, are you serious? Okay, the red kite, the falcon, and the kite after that kind. What?
Okay.
That's it?
And so this is a verse which is part of a list it's the same list that appears in Leviticus 11. It's the list of birds that are forbidden to eat. Hmm. And you know, for the land animals, we've got two signs, split hoof and chew its cud. For the sea animals, we've got two signs, We've got the snapil v'kaskeset. We've got the fins and scales. For the birds, we don't have signs. We've got a list of birds that are forbidden. Mm-hmm. And the list is identical between Leviticus 11 and Deuteronomy 14, except in Deuteronomy 14, 13, there is a slight difference. So now I'm going to ask you, Jono, mm-hmm. keep your finger on Deuteronomy 14, 13, and look at 11, 14 of Leviticus and tell mm-hmm. me what the difference is.
11:14 says the kites and the falcon after its kind. Oh, okay. Hang on a minute.
Somebody say,
yeah, the kites and the falcon after its kind. I've got, okay, so let me just, all right. So it says the red kite, the falcon and the kite after that kind.
And what's interesting, if you read any two translations, you're going to see differences between the translations, which adds to the confusion. So for example, the King James in Leviticus 11:14 has, and the vulture and the kite after its kind, or after his kind rather. Deuteronomy 14:13 has, and the gleed and the kite and the vulture after his kind. So it adds, and the gleed. I don't know what a gleed is. I don't know what a kite is. Whatever. I know what they are in Hebrew, more or less. But I mean, they're various birds of prey. So anyway, Leviticus 11:14 verses 14:13. Let me read it to you in the Hebrew, okay?
Sure.
And I'm going to use English. I'm going to read it in English, but I'm going to say the names of the birds in the Hebrew, okay? Now this might be a little bit too advanced for some people. If this is confusing and it challenges your faith, then please just fast forward and skip ahead. And probably in about 3 minutes you'll hear Keith preaching about something. Right now Keith snuck off to get a drink. Leviticus 11:14 says, "And the da'a and the ayah after its kind." Now da'a and ayah are two different types of bird.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Deuteronomy 14:13 says, "And the ra'a and the ayah and the da'a." After its kind. So what happened here? So Leviticus 11:14 and 14:13 both have two in common, ayah. And so let's cross ayah out. And then we've got, because it's the same in both. And they both have something called the da'a or the da'ya, which is the same thing, the da'a or the da'ya. So Deuteronomy 14:13 has an extra bird, the ra'a. So how did it get a bird called the ra'a? And here's a little hint. There is no such bird called the ra'a. Uh-oh.
What is that tweeting in the background? Is that a ra'a?
That's actually birds. No, I think those are like pigeons or something. I don't know what they are. They're some like domesticated bird.
Okay.
So we've got those are Jerusalem birds.
Nice.
Like apparently like the heat.
They're singing for you.
Yeah. So we've got, okay. So long story short, we've got the da'a in Leviticus, and in Deuteronomy we've got the da'ya and the ra'a. So what happened? And what probably happened is that in ancient Hebrew, and in later Hebrew as well, the resh and the dalet, two Hebrew letters that don't sound any bit alike, are written almost identically. Okay.
What are you suggesting?
Mm-hmm. What I'm suggesting is what happened is somebody was copying Deuteronomy, and he accidentally wrote ra'a instead of da'a. And because, like I said, they're virtually identical. To
and remind me what the da'a is.
So the da'a is some type of bird that they translate here as the red kite. In another translation, it's some kind of bird of prey.
Look, the ra'a is the parrot. He parroted the da'a. That we have the ra'a.
No.
Now let's move on.
No. Bear with me for 30 more seconds.
And then we'll move on.
No, keep going.
So basically what probably happened is somebody was copying Deuteronomy, and he wrote accidentally ra'a instead of da'a, which is virtually identical. And think about it in English. You've got, like, in certain fonts, you've got a capital I, which is identical to the L. You know what I'm talking about? Like in the Arial, for example.
Sure.
You can't actually tell the difference between an I and a capital I and a lowercase L. Sorry. Capital I and lowercase L. So he wrote ra'a instead of da'a. And then the proofreader came along and said, oh, no, that's a mistake. And in the margin, he wrote in the margin and the da'ya, meaning he corrected it in the margin. And then, now again, we don't have this text, but this is probably what happened. And then at a later point, somebody came to copy that text and he said, okay, I've got one reading in the text and one in the margin. I'm just going to put them together because I'm not going to put it in the margin. And he ended up writing and the ra'a and the ayah and the da'ya after its kind. In other words, he took the marginal reading and inserted it into the text. And that's why we have 21 birds in Deuteronomy, including one bird that doesn't exist, the Ra'a, and 20 birds in Leviticus.
Wow. So what are you telling me? What are you telling me, Keith, if I understand this correctly? There's an imaginary bird that's been added to the text that we cannot eat even if we tried.
I'll tell you why this is so interesting to me. So here's an example where I can point to, and look, you could try to come with some explanation where, yes, the ra'ah is really an otherwise unknown type of da'ah, and it's a variant. And that's what they did in some of the translations. They have the red kite and the black kite. And so we're just kind of like, you know, blurring this together. There's different types of kites. And one is a Reish and one is a Dalid. But what probably happened is this is a mistake. And what's so beautiful to me is the mistake was corrected, and it was so carefully copied, they even copied the correction. They said, okay, somebody corrected it, but I'm not going to change scripture. I'm not going to use my own opinion to change scripture. I'm going to copy it exactly the way I received it, even with the mistake.
Mm.
And that's amazing to me. That shows me how carefully they were copying scripture. And what's interesting is I don't know off the top of my head of any other examples like this in the Torah, meaning this is a very rare thing where you can point to something like this and say, yep, we've got a mistake here. And that shows me how accurate the text of the Hebrew Bible
is. That's a good point. That's fascinating. Yep. Anything to add there?
I'm telling you what happened, guys. Can I tell you what happened?
What happened, Kate?
What happened? Moses was so angry that he couldn't go into the promised land because he broke a command that he added an extra bird.
Just to really make
just
people
to throw them off. Birds.
No, he was writing the Torah and a bird pooped on him and he's like, I'm going to show that bird.
All right, now here's one that I've always wondered about, and I'm jumping ahead. I'm going to go to verse 21. Keith, this is it. If I go out in my field and I find a goat that somehow died overnight, I'm not allowed to eat that, but I can sell it to Gentile Jimmy down the road. What's with that?
You may sell it to a foreigner.
Yeah, I can sell it to a foreigner.
You may sell it to a foreigner, but you are a people holy to Yehovah your God.
If one of my goats died, I can't have it, but I can sell it to Gentile Jimmy.
It actually says the sojourner can eat it as well.
How about that?
Which is kind of mysterious, because in other places it says there's one Torah for the native-born and the sojourner. And so this is kind of an anomaly. This is an anomaly along with one other verse, and that other verse, if we're going to already point these things out, is, I believe, in Leviticus 23. Hold on. In Leviticus 23, it says, verse 42, it says, in Sukkot you will dwell, meaning in booths you will dwell 7 days. Every native born in Israel shall dwell in booths. Well, what about the sojourner? Why isn't he mentioned here? And some people have actually pointed to this verse and said, well, there's two commandments where the sojourner is different than the native born Israelite. One has to do with what you just read in Deuteronomy, and the other is this verse. Now,
yeah,
I would argue,
I'd go to Exodus chapter 12, and doesn't it say that one law shall be for the native born and for the stranger who dwells among you? Because doesn't it say somewhere he shall be as a native of the land, it says in verse 48.
Okay, I agree with you. But I think the explanation for Leviticus 23:42, which is much easier than Deuteronomy 14, is that the sojourner, or the concept in Hebrew of sojourner, is kind of what we would call today, how do I put it? The word ger in Hebrew is somebody who doesn't own land. And so basically they're homeless.
Mm-hmm.
So telling the homeless person live in a booth for 7 days, well, he lives in a booth every day.
Sure. Okay, fair enough.
So, you know, so he doesn't need that commandment. You know, he's living in a booth all the time.
Sure.
And so I think that's the answer for Leviticus 23. Whereas Deuteronomy 14, look, this is a mystery to me. In other words, how do we explain this, that this seems, you know, contrary to what we read in several passages? Exodus 12, I think, didn't we see in Numbers 15 as a second witness that that also there was one commandment for the sojourner and the native born? And let me read that verse. Maybe Keith can read that verse since he's kind of quiet over there. In the Hebrew, it's 15 and 16.
The priest is to sacrifice them, the one for a sin offering.
Numbers. Didn't I say Numbers?
Yeah, you said Leviticus. Are we going to Numbers?
Numbers, you got it. Not what I say, what I mean. Numbers 15, 15 to 16.
Okay.
Numbers 15 to 16.
Can't you read my mind? What's wrong with you, Pew?
Okay. The community is to have the same rules for you and for the alien living among you. This is a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. You and the alien shall be the same before Yehovah.
Mm.
The same laws and regulations will apply both to you and to the alien living among you.
I think it's much more powerful in Hebrew, where it says, Torah achat, one Torah, umishvat achat, and one judgment shall be for you, for the sojourner who sojourns among you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So for you and the sojourner sojourns among you, there's one Torah and one judgment. So how do we explain Deuteronomy 14? I'm going to defer this one to the Methodist.
Keith, come on.
How Moses. I explain it is that Moses is preaching, and he's saying, this is what the deal is, and this is what the deal is. This is the same Torah, and this is added to the Torah. This is not an added outside of the Torah. This is the progression of Torah. And so now I'm telling you, if you find this goat, this is what you can do for the sojourner. It's still the still one Torah. It's from Genesis, Bereshit, all the way through to Devarim. This is still the Torah. It's not like we're reading in Jonah.
The point is that I'm not allowed to eat that, and Jonah is, or, well, Jonah's. I'm not allowed to eat it, and you are, Keith? I mean, is that the goat's carcass? That's what it sounds like. It's, I don't know. We're missing something here.
It's a curious verse.
Moses is still angry.
Let's just leave it at that. But there's another one. There's another one for deep pondering, deep consideration. Keith, I want to know something.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever boiled a young goat in its mother's milk?
No, but I've heard this one many times. This is very interesting. I know people will enjoy it. So
haven't we talked about this?
Yes, we have. But I figure you'll talk about it again.
You're very astute. I actually want to tell a joke. So three times in the Torah, it says word for word, "Lo tevashel gedib chalev imo." Do not boil a kid in its mother's milk. Three times, word for word. And if you ask the rabbis, they'll say, "Well, if God, this isn't a joke yet. This is actually fact. This is true. They say if God says something more than once, then he must mean different things each time he says it, because you know God's perfect and he speaks perfectly and concisely, and so you know it's as if Scripture is a divine code. This is what the rabbis said." And therefore, if God says something more than once, he means three different things. And what does he mean with the three different things? And actually, there's a debate in the Mishnah in the writings of the early rabbis about what he means. But basically, it means you may not boil a kid in its you may not boil meat and milk together, any meat and any milk. You may not eat meat and milk that were boiled together. And the third thing is you may not benefit from meat and milk that were boiled together. What does it mean by benefit? It means you can't even feed it to a dog. Sorry, Georgia, blessed memory. The joke goes as follows. Now, the rabbis take this verse, "Do not boil a kid in his mother's milk," and they say it means you can't eat meat and milk together. In fact, you have to have separate dishes when you eat meat and milk. In fact, and that's actually true. I mean, the rabbis say that. This isn't the joke yet. The rabbis, if you're an Orthodox Jew, you've got two separate sets of plates in your house and two sets of forks and two sets of knives. And growing up as an Orthodox Jew in my family, we actually had a set of silverware that had a blue handle for milk, and we had a set of silverware with the red handle for meat. And when I say milk, I don't just mean milk. I mean anything that's a dairy product. I mean cheese, and I mean, you know, if you had lasagna, there couldn't be meat in the lasagna. It had to be either a dairy lasagna or a meat lasagna, but it couldn't be mixed. And so if you were having a dairy lasagna, you would use a blue fork, and if you had a meat lasagna, you'd use a red fork. Now, not everybody color codes them. That's what we did in my family. Wow. But the point is you have to have two separate sets of dishes, two separate sets of silverware, of cutlery, as they say in Australia, and so the point is, and then the third thing is, after you eat meat, you've got to wait a period of time until you're allowed to eat milk. Now, the more devout Orthodox Jews actually wait for 6 hours. The more, I would say, liberal ones only wait for about an hour. So in my family, we waited 6 hours. So if we had meat, a meat meal, like if we had steak or something, or we had even chicken, believe it or not, then we had to wait for 6 hours before we could have ice cream.
Oh, and we really did. That's suffering.
It really is. Now imagine if it's a hot Shabbat and you have a big meat lunch, and then and then you want to have some ice cream in the afternoon. You're out of luck. You know, you got to wait until the evening, pretty much. Here's the joke. All of that wasn't a joke. The joke is that Moses is up on Mount Sinai. This is a joke an Orthodox Jew told me. Moses is up on Mount Sinai, and God says to him, "Moses." That's what God sounds like. "Moses, do not boil a kid in its mother's milk." Actually, I think that's my dad's voice, but
that is your dad's voice.
Right.
"Moses, do not boil a kid in its mother's milk." And Moses says, "What do you mean by that?" "Oh, I know what you mean. You mean don't eat meat and milk together." "Moses, do not boil a kid in its mother's milk." "What do you mean by that?" "Oh, I know what you mean. You mean have separate dishes for meat and milk." "Moses, do not boil a kid in its mother's milk." "Well, what do you mean by that?" "Oh, you mean wait for 6 hours after I eat meat until I eat milk." And then God says, "Whatever you want."
I tried three times.
That's why it's three times. Exodus 23, Exodus 34, and Deuteronomy 14. Check it out. Three times. Do not boil a kid in its mother's milk. And, of course, the historical reason we know today, and actually some of the ancient authors knew this as well, medieval authors knew this, the reason is that the pagans would boil a kid in the milk of its mother as a fertility offering to their goddess. In fact, to this day in Lebanon, and I point out Lebanon is the one place where the Canaanites survived. They were never really conquered from Lebanon because there are mountains there. It's very difficult to conquer. And so out in the mountains, a lot of ancient traditions still survive. And out there in the mountains of Lebanon, to this day, there's a delicacy boiling a kid in the milk of its mother.
Wow. There didn't
it
know that.
Now they don't offer it to a pagan goddess anymore. But that way of eating is still remembered there. And there's actually a restaurant in Tel Aviv, I'm not making this up, where they offer a kid boiled in the milk of its mother. And they do this just to piss people off.
Oh, you're kidding me. Are you serious in Tel Aviv?
I'm dead serious.
That blows my mind.
Disgusting. Yeah.
Man, you wouldn't want to live in that neighborhood, Keith.
No.
Oh, my word. That blows my mind. And you know what? It says exactly what you just said, Nehemiah. It says that in my study notes here, that so even the Christian Bible understands this is just another form of God saying, don't be like the pagans. Don't do what the pagans do. I'm telling you what to do. All right? All right, we got to start
taking fertility rights.
There it is. We got to start hammering through these. So I'm going to.
What do you mean? This is the end. This has been 2 hours. Are you kidding me?
Oh, this is going to be a record. Keith.
This is going to be the longest one.
Don't worry about Keith. I'm about to talk about tithing. Okay, it's all right.
Oh,
you shall.
Please God.
You shall.
Makor, MAKOR Hebrew Foundation, PO Box. Find it on the website, makorhebrew.org, nehemiahswall.com.
I think you're out of luck because I don't think you're a Levite. It says you shall surely, you truly. All the increase of the grain that the field produces year by year, and you shall eat before Yehovah your God in the place where he chooses to make his name abide, the tithe of the grain and the new wine and the oil and the firstborn of your herds and the flocks, that you may learn to fear Yehovah your God always. But if the journey is too long for you, that you are not able to carry the tithe, or if the place where Yehovah your God chooses to put his name is too far for you, then Yehovah your God, when Yehovah your God has blessed you, then you shall exchange it for money, take the money in your hand, and go to the place which Yehovah your God chooses. And if you shall and you shall spend the money.
Hear that, people? We're not just taking produce. We're taking cash, cold hard cash.
We're taking the money to. It seems like we can spend on whatever our heart desires, on sheep or oxen or wine or wine or similar drink, for whatever your heart desires. You shall eat there before Yehovah your God. You shall rejoice, you and your household. You shall not forsake the Levite who is within your gates, for he has no part nor inheritance with you. At the end of every third year, you shall bring out the tithe of your produce that of that year that is stored up within your gates. And the Levite, because he has no portion nor inheritance with you, the stranger and the fatherless and the widow who are within your gates may come and eat and be satisfied that Yehovah your God may bless you in all the work of your hand which you do. Boy, there's a little bit of math in this section of chapter 14 that is a bit over my head, I reckon.
So we've got three passages that talk about tithing, and there's others, but three main passages. And one is over in Leviticus where it talks about giving the tithe to the Levite. The second one is verses 22 through 27, which talks about taking the tithe up to Jerusalem. And the third one is verses 28 to 29 of this chapter, Deuteronomy 14, which talks about, or in mine it's 28 to 29, which talks about, at the end of every third year, giving it to the poor, including the Levite, because he has no portion with you. And so this has been interpreted in various ways. The rabbinical interpretation has been to say, well, there's really two tithes. We're talking about 20%. 10% goes to the Levite. The other 10% goes either for the pilgrimage, which is what it's really talking about in verses 22 through 27. You have to appear three times a year for the pilgrimage. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about the next chapter. And you bring it to Jerusalem at that time or wherever you come on the pilgrimage. And you spend it on your pilgrimage, on pilgrimage feasts. And then in the third year, then you give it to the poor and the Levite. So that's 20%. And the rabbis refer to that as the first tithe and the second tithe. And the second tithe essentially has a variation in the third year. It goes to an alternative purpose. There have actually been some groups who have said that, no, it's 30% every year, 30%, three tithes, 30%. And the third year tithe, well, you just collect it for the first 2 years. And then at the end of the third year, you give this cumulated 3 years worth of 10% to the poor and the Levite. So those are two interpretations that are out there. A third interpretation, which is one I'm going to suggest here, which is that all three are talking about the same 10%. And to me, the proof that it's all three of the same 10% is in verses 27 and 29. We're talking about the Levite, and it says, "For he has no portion and inheritance with you," which is kind of strange because according to the rabbinical interpretation, he sure does have a portion and inheritance. He's got 10%.
Yeah.
In other words, why does he need my 10% that I use for my pilgrimage feast if he's got the 10% I gave him last week? Why does he need this part of the second 10% if he's already got the first 10%? And then also in verse 29, that's even more clear that he's along with the poor. He's got nothing, right? And so you got to give him of that 10%. What I argue is that actually all three are talking about the same tithe. And it's different things are being done with this tithe. It's being used for the pilgrimage, and then part of it is being given to the poor, and part of that is being given to the Levite. Now, I know that's controversial, and I know definitely there are some people who don't want to hear that, but as I say, as a Karaite, search well in the scripture, and do not rely on my opinion.
So Keith, it says, in Malachi 3, 8, 9, and 10, it says, "Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, well, why have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into my storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says Yehovah, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it." And I know, Keith, I know a lot of people, particularly coming from my tradition, your tradition perhaps as well, that go, well, I want to be blessed. I don't want to be cursed. So, what do I do with my 10%? I don't know what to do with it.
Right.
How are we to apply that now?
Right. The folks have gone to great lengths to apply it for us. And that's what they basically say. Here's what you're supposed to do. Bring it into the storehouse. The church is now the storehouse. Bring your tithe into the storehouse. There might be meat. And the list goes on and on. And that's the whole issue, is that, it's all been done away with except for tithing. And then we go to verses like this and argue about we're building up a new church. We're building a new building. And therefore, my house is in ruins. And this is now my house. It's the temple. It's replacement. The list goes on and on and on.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does. But looking at this, we're looking at the Levite, the widow, the poor, the fatherless, and the stranger.
And that's where I think there is something really powerful in that, is that, so when we do have those that are in need that don't have the ability, when you look at the widow and the orphan, back to my favorite New Testament book of James, what is true religion? The widows and orphans in their distress. Where did James get that? Certainly the idea that, there are people surrounded that don't have the ability to have resources so that we're able to help them. And that's where I think it's a concept that we need to apply is how can we support those that do not have.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Okay.
Hey, so if you're already in the book of James, where in the New Testament, help me out here as an ignorant Jew, where in the New Testament is the verse that talks about tithing?
Oh, it's only the Paul says set aside that beginning of the week as you normally do, and this is what you're to set aside, and so that when I come, I do not have to bother you for this matter. Doesn't talk.
So when I come, I can just clean up, and I don't have to chase it up.
Exactly.
Right, but does he say tithe over there?
No.
Mm-mm. No.
Uh-oh.
Interesting.
No.
Mm. Okay.
Moving along. So, at the end of every 7 years, you shall grant the release of debts. Now, boy, wouldn't that'd solve a lot of problems, wouldn't it, today? Man.
Yeah.
Oh, this is the form of the release. Every creditor who has lent anything to his neighbor shall release it. He shall not require it of his neighbor or his brother, because it is called Yehovah's release. Of a foreigner you may require it, but you shall give up your claim to what is owed by your brother, except when there may be no poor among you. For Yehovah will greatly bless you in the land which Yehovah your God is giving you to possess as an inheritance. Only if you carefully obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe with care all these commandments which I command you to this day, for Yehovah your God will bless you as he promised. You shall lend to nations, but you shall not borrow. You shall reign over many nations, but they shall not reign over you. Does that mean that it's, is it against Torah to borrow?
No, on the contrary. So this is a really interesting statement here. It's making a distinction between lending to someone who's one of your people and lending to a foreign nations, pagan mm-hmm. nations. And it's actually a blessing to lend to the foreign nations, and it's a mm-hmm. curse to be a borrower. And then also, lending is essentially a form of domination, and being a borrower is a form of slavery, which is mm-hmm. a really amen. Interesting concept.
Amen.
I get an amen from everybody out there who owes yes. money.
Yeah.
Yes. Amen.
Mm. Let me just point out that mm. this is where in the Middle Ages the church got the idea from this verse is where the church got the idea that Jews should be moneylenders. They said, well, we're the new Israel. We, the church, are the new Israel, and it's forbidden for one Israelite to lend money to another Israelite on interest. And since we want to be able to borrow money on interest, we need someone who's not an Israelite. And mm. so they said, okay, let's make the Jews be the moneylenders. And they actually forbade the Jews from in many countries in Europe from engaging in any other kind of business. Now, remember, we're talking about a period where 98% of human beings in the Middle Ages are farmers. And mm-hmm. the Jews are forbidden from farming. They're even forbidden from being serfs. Like, I'm talking about like essentially a form of slavery, you know, serfdom. They're forbidden from doing that. What they're allowed to do is they're allowed to be merchants in many countries. And in some countries, the only thing they're allowed to do is to be moneylenders. And this is why you end up with, you know, and I'm saying in all seriousness, this is why you end up with many Jews. Even to this day, there's some prominent Jewish families who are, you know, bankers, who are, you know, famous banking families, because in the Middle Ages, that's what they were allowed to do. And they were forced into doing it. And
so they were restricted to doing.
They were restricted to doing, right. They didn't have, you know, they could be beggars or they could be bankers. Those were, you know, and I think most Jews would choose the latter. You know, that's why you have families like the Rothschilds, who are a famous banking family. Mm. You know, and although statistically, I think you can prove that very easily that most bankers are not Jewish, contrary to popular belief. But there are some prominent Jews who are bankers. And, you know, it came from the church's, the Catholic Church's interpretation of this particular passage.
Very
that
interesting.
You can only lend to a foreigner, and you can't lend to one of your people, and only foreigners can lend to you. And so, okay, the Jews aren't Israelites. We're the new Israel. I mean, isn't that ironic? How strange.
Mm-hmm. How about that?
Anyway, yep.
So if there is among you a poor man of your brethren with any of the gates within your land, which Jehovah your God is giving you, you shall not harden your heart nor shut your hand from your poor brother, but you shall open your hand wide to him and willingly lend him sufficient for his need, whatever he needs. Beware lest a wicked thought enter your heart, saying in the seventh year, the year of release is at hand, and your eye be evil against your poor brother, and you give him nothing. And he cry out to Jehovah against you, and it becomes sin among you. You shall surely give him, and your heart should not be grieved when you give to him, because for this thing Jehovah your God will bless you, and all the works, and in all which you put your hand, for the poor will never cease. Keith, I've heard that before too. The poor will never cease from the land. Therefore, I command you, saying, you shall open your hand wide to your brother, to your poor and your needy in the land. That reminds me of where it says evil eye. That's a funny sort of an expression. What is that in Hebrew?
It says, and your eye will become evil.
Your eye will become evil. I've got, it takes me to Proverbs 23, verse 6. Do not eat the bread of a miser is what I've got. But I know in some translations, I think one who has an evil eye, nor desire his delicacies, for he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you. This is Proverbs 23, verses 6, 7, and 8. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. The morsel you have eaten, you will vomit up and waste your pleasant words.
Right. And so it literally says, do not eat the bread of one who has an evil eye. And basically from Deuteronomy, in this context, they're saying, okay, to have an evil eye in biblical Hebrew means to be a cheapskate, a stingy person.
Yeah, that's what it says in Proverbs 28, 22. A man with an evil eye hastens after riches and does not consider that poverty will overcome, will come upon him. Evil eye, it's an interesting phrase. You wanted to go to 16.
Well, so Deuteronomy 16, why don't we, you know, jump ahead to there. There we've got the feasts. And this is one of my favorite passages in the whole Bible. Shamo et chodesh ha'aviv. Observe the month of the Aviv. V'asita pesach la'yehovah Elohecha. And do the Passover to Jehovah your God. Remember, in the Tanakh, in the Hebrew Bible, Passover is always a sacrifice. So do mm-hmm. the Passover. It isn't the feast, it's a sacrifice. Ki b'chodesh ha'aviv hotziyacha Yehovah Elohecha b'mitzrayim laila. For in the month of the Aviv, Jehovah your God took you out of Egypt by night. And this is actually a very controversial verse, believe it or not. And the reason it's controversial is Numbers 3:3:3. It says, which we read in a previous portion, they set out from Ramses in the first month, on the 15th day of the month. It was on the morrow of the Passover offering that the Israelites started out defiantly in the view, in plain view of all the Egyptians. Now, some of the translations say the day after the Passover, but the Hebrew is very much more specific. It says the morrow of the Passover, which in Hebrew would be mocharat, means the morning following the Passover. Mm-hmm. So they left. So that means they left in the morning.
Hmm.
So why does it say here in verse 1 at night, in Deuteronomy 16:1?
Interesting.
Any ideas?
Because Moses is mad.
I think you're mad because we've been going for 2 hours.
That's the answer to everything
It's really interesting. I actually love the verse in Deuteronomy, and I've looked at it a lot, especially as it pertains to God's clock. This whole idea, when I'm looking in Deuteronomy, you know, it makes complete sense to me because I know that, you know, we're dealing with the 14th, the middle of the month where the moon is full. And it's like I like to say for those children at night during Sukkot that say, I'm scared. He said, no, Yehovah left his nightlight on. So that this idea of them coming out under a full moon. But, you know, this challenge regarding the morning and the night, the question would become, what would be the definition of morning? Meaning, would it be after the sun has risen or would it be before?
That's an interesting question, but I don't know if that's the solution. In other words, morning definitely in some Hebrew context could be really from when you have something called the morning star, which today we refer to as Venus, the planet Venus. But in Jewish sources, it talks about the morning star is really the beginning of the morning, because that's when you can first see. You know, and they utilized every second of light that they had because they didn't have electricity. So if you have this, you know, the star up in the sky and you can, you know, at least get out to your fields, maybe you can't do a lot of, you know, precise plowing and stuff, but you can get out to the fields and, you know, walk on the paths, then you take advantage of that. But I don't think the issue is the definition of mourning here. I think the issue actually is something a little bit different. So can I read Rashi? Rashi was a Jewish Bible commentator in the 12th century, and he offers the following explanation. He says, did they not go out during the day, as it is written? On the morrow of the Passover, the children of Israel went out. He quotes Numbers 33:3, just as I did. I mean, I didn't make this up. So, but rather, because Pharaoh gave them permission at night to leave, as it is written. And then he quotes Exodus 12:31. And he called Moses and Aaron at night. And he said, get up and go out from the midst of my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go worship Jehovah your God as you have spoken. So Rashi's explanation is to say that, well, they went out during the morning, we know that, but they were told to leave at night. And so basically from that moment that Pharaoh said, get out, they were legally free. And so that's his explanation.
So I would agree with that. And can I add just my own thoughts, which is we're talking about, you know, what, 2, maybe 3 million people, do you think?
Yep.
I mean, that amount of people, they don't leave quickly. I mean, if everyone heads out onto that amount of people heads out onto the street, it's still going to be considerable hours before they, because it does say they leave in their ranks, right? There's an order to which they leave. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that would be over in just a matter of hours. I think that would probably be the better half of a 24-hour period, right?
I don't know about that, but I mean, if you're trying to get out of slavery, I think you're going to run. And they were prepared. Remember, they ate the Passover sacrifice with their belts on their, you know, with their loins girded and their staff in their hand, ready to leave at any second. So I think the minute they got the go-ahead, they were, you know, they were ready to, they were good to go. But, you know, and it still may have taken a few hours, undoubtedly. You know, but anyway, I want to offer another explanation, which is a little bit more complicated. But one of the things that you have in biblical Hebrew is you'll have these little clauses which will kind of be stuck at the end of the verse. And what I mean by that is that you can really read this verse, observe the month of the Aviv and do the Passover to Jehovah your God at night, for in the month of the Aviv, Jehovah your God took you up out of Egypt. Mm-hmm. In other words, that statement by night or at night, that, you know, sometimes they'll just stick that kind of clause at the end, that little part of the sentence, and really it goes to something earlier in the chapter. And there's a really funny example. So an interesting example is Genesis 14, verse 12. Mm-hmm. And maybe you could read that in yours, Jonah, Genesis 14, 12. Because in the English, you won't see it. But when you read it in Hebrew, you see that the word order is just like in this verse or similar.
And so they took Lot, Abraham's brother's son who dwelt in Sodom, and his goods, and departed.
Okay, so what it says in Hebrew is, and they took Lot and his goods, the son of Abraham's brother, and they went, and they departed. So it switches around.
They took the son of Abraham's brother. Right.
Well, no, they took Lot and his property, the son of Abraham's brother, the son of the brother of Abraham. No, the point is that they put the phrase, the son of the brother of Abraham, after the statement, and his property.
Mm-hmm.
They kind of just stuck it at the end there. And that might be too complicated for some people. It's kind of a grammatical thing.
It's definitely too complicated.
Well, we clearly have taken away Moses' preaching of Deuteronomy. There's just no question.
We're trying to understand.
No, I'm just telling you what's happened.
Long story short, my way of reading this is, observe the month of the Aviv and do the Passover to Jehovah your God at night. For the month of the Aviv, Jehovah your God took you up out of Egypt. That's how
Amen.
I read it.
Amen.
And but it could be read the other way too, obviously.
No, I'm saying we've taken Moses' preaching of Deuteronomy right out the door. He's not preaching anymore.
You've got to understand the grammar before we can understand what he's saying. You know, 3,500 years ago, they understood him without a problem. Today, we've got to work a little harder at it. So,
indeed. And no leaven shall be seen among you in all your territory 7 days, nor shall any of the meat which you sacrifice in the first day of twilight remain overnight until morning. You may not sacrifice the Passover within your gates, which Jehovah your God gives you, but in the place where Jehovah your God chooses to make his name abide, there you shall sacrifice the Passover at twilight, at the going down of the sun, at the time you came out of Egypt. There's even more clarification. That's kind of like...
And that basically means I can't do it in my backyard. I've got to do it at the chosen place.
There it is. Okay. We're flying along. You shall count 7 weeks for yourself to begin. We've got the counting of the Amor, right? This is the 7 weeks from the time you begin to put the sickle to the grain. Then you shall keep the Feast of Weeks to Jehovah your God with the tribute of a freewill offering from your hand, which you shall give as Jehovah your God blesses you. You shall rejoice before Jehovah your God and your son, your daughter, your male and female servants, the Levite who's within your gates, the stranger and the fatherless, the widow who are among you, at the place where Jehovah your God chooses to make his name abide. And you shall remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and you shall be careful to observe his statutes. The Feast of Tabernacles. You shall observe the Feast of Tabernacles 7 days when you have gathered from your threshing floor and from your winepress, and you shall rejoice in your feast, in your sons and your daughters, and your male and female servants, and the Levite, and the stranger, and the fatherless, and the widow, and within your gates. 7 days you shall keep a sacred feast to Jehovah your God, the place where Jehovah chooses, because Jehovah your God will bless you in all your produce and in all the work of your hands, so you will surely rejoice.
And let me point out that you know, in Leviticus 23 and Numbers 28 and 29, we hear about how there's an eighth day of Sukkot, and it's called, mm-hmm. it's actually not part of Sukkot. Sukkot's 7 days, and then there's an eighth day called Shemini Atzeret, the eighth day of assembly. It's eighth from the counting of Sukkot, but it's not technically, meaning you only dwell in the booth for 7 days, yes. And then you've got this eighth day where you assemble, and that's actually not mentioned here.
Amen. Keith, we've got two more verses, and I think we've set another record. Will you please give us...
Before he closes it out, can I just give a real quick, really, really quick synopsis the whole... anyway, so we've got three pilgrimage feasts, meaning three times a year we're committed to appear before Jehovah. That's the Feast of Unleavened Bread, or Chag HaMatzot in Hebrew. Mm. People often will call that Passover because of the sacrifice at the beginning of it, but it's actually technically the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks, and Sukkot, the Feast of Booths. Those are the three pilgrimage feasts. However, we have 7 days of rest, or seven rest festivals. Mm-hmm. The first and seventh day of unleavened bread are days in which you're not allowed to work, days of rest. Shavuot is a day in which you're not allowed to work, a day of rest. Yom Teruah, or the Day of Trumpets, some people call it the Day of Shouting. Rabbinical Jews refer to it as Rosh Hashanah. Yom Teruah, the Day of Shouting, is a day of rest. That's the first day of the seventh month. Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, is a sixth day of rest. The fifth day of rest out of the seven, and then the first day of Sukkot and the eighth day, those are the final 2 days of rest. So you see there are some biblical appointed times, specifically Yom Teruah and Yom Kippur, which are not pilgrimage feasts, and then you have the three pilgrimage feasts, Feast of Unleavened Bread, Shavuot, and Sukkot.
There is the last two verses. Keith Johnson, take it away.
Which verses do you want me to read?
chapter 16 from 16 to 17.
Okay.
Three times a year?
Mm.
Oh, boy.
I've got a comment I want to talk about the word three. No, I'm just kidding.
Somebody say the Trinity. Three times a year, all your men must appear before Yehovah your God at the place he will choose at the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Weeks, and the Feast of Tabernacles. No man should appear before Yehovah empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way Yehovah your God has blessed you. What a blessing that is.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So bring a token of the blessing. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Beautiful. I like that.
Mm-hmm. If he blessed you, then you need to bring a blessing to to him.
Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Amen. So that is it. That boy. Now you
I'm
know what?
Sorry, we can't end. We didn't say a prayer, and I'm going to say the prayer before.
Man, we almost skipped the prayer.
No, we got to make it all the way through.
It's
here
the scales on our eyes.
Yes.
It's yeah.
Yehovah, thank you so much for this opportunity, for this very important portion, but not only the portion, but just the idea of working through your word. Help us to have our eyes open that we might see these wonderful things, these blessed things, these amazing things that are hidden in your Torah. And help us also be a people that will be thankful for what we do have and to be able to come to you with that thanksgiving and to bless others as you have blessed us.
Amen, amen. This has got to be a record for sure. You have been listening to the Torah Pills on Truth To You Radio. We can also freely download this and other Torah Pills programs at truthtoyou.org. Truth To You, that's truth2u.org. And next week we are in Shoftim, Deuteronomy 16:18-21:9. And until then, dear listeners, be blessed and be set apart by the truth of our Father's word. Shalom.